Rick Meyer, quarterback, Notre Dame. He resisted the temptation to take his talents early to the NFL because there's unfinished work in college, a national championship, a possible Heisman. Today, Meyer leads a Fighting Irish team that is an offensive powerhouse. Under the watchful eye of Coach Lou Holtz, Meyer is complimented by junior fullback Jerome Bettis, who knows his team's aspirations, and tight end Irv Smith, who lets nothing come between him and the end zone. Their opponent, the fifth-ranked Michigan Wolverines, led by their own golden boy, quarterback Elvis Gerbach, a man with Heisman dreams of his own. Last year, he crushed Notre Dame's season with this amazing fourth-down play to his high school teammate, Heisman winner Desmond Howard. But Howard left Michigan early for the NFL. Gerbach and the Wolverines look for a victory at Notre Dame today to start them on the road to a national title. Afternoon in South Bend, the Michigan Wolverines take the field. Championship contest, demand for tickets the most in recent memory, the two most successful college programs of all time, two teams with national title aspirations quarterbacked by Heisman Trophy candidates. Hello, everyone, and welcome to South Bend, Indiana, Notre Dame Stadium. Tom Hammond with Chris Collinsworth. What an emotional moment, Chris, for a college player taking the field, Michigan and Notre Dame. But the problem might be, how do you channel that emotion to start the contest?
Tom, if these young men can channel their emotions at this point, they're not human. Don't forget, they're only between 18 and 22 years of age. And really, one of the keys in any college football game is which team can gain control of their emotions first. We'll keep an eye on that.
Well, we've heard all about the two quarterbacks, two high-powered offenses on display today. Will this be a high-scoring game? What do you expect?
Well, I don't know. The big story in this ball game has to be Notre Dame's defense. Of course, without Demetrius DeBose, this is a football team that gave up over 400 yards of offense last week against Northwestern. Michigan is a much more powerful offense. They have three running backs that have averaged more than 5 yards per carry. So the storyline of this ball game, not so much the quarterbacks, but the defense of Michigan.
Well, when you have two teams relatively evenly matched as we have today, often it's a surprise, a gimmick that sways the balance. For more on that, let's go to the sideline and John Dockery.
And Tom Hammond, we might see exactly that from the Irish today. Some offensive surprise possible. You know, Lou Holtz, normally conservative, talks about running the ball to win. Well, all week long in practices, he's been working on the wide open offense. And I'm talking wide open. Four wide receivers, five wide receivers, no backs in the backfield. And you and I both know that a coach doesn't spend significant time in practice unless he's going to use something. So it will be interesting today to see if we see the unveiling of Air Holtz here against Michigan. Back to you, Tom.
All right, Doc. Lou Holtz, it would be a surprise if it was Air Holtz. That would be out of character for him. But as we said, it may be a surprise that turns the tide today. And do we expect a close game? Well, look at this. The last five here at Notre Dame Stadium have been decided on the final series or even the final play. Gary Moeller and his Michigan Wolverines hoping before the season is over to take an unprecedented fifth straight Big Ten title. They beat Notre Dame last year, and Rick Meyer, when he made his debut 2 years ago for the Irish at quarterback, engineered a win over the Wolverines. Elvis Gerbach, the most efficient passer in college football last year. Notre Dame has won the toss, and the Irish have elected to receive. Game time temperature 69 degrees, a perfect afternoon in South Bend.
And don't forget, this is the opener for Michigan. Had a chance to talk with Gary Moeller, and he said that most college football teams improve more from week one to week two than any other span during the course of the season. He said you just learned so much about your football team after that first game. Of course, Notre Dame had the game last week against Northwestern, and the fact that Notre Dame is now playing at home, he thinks that gives the Irish a huge edge in this one.
Peter Elizovic will kick off for Michigan. And the return by Burris, who takes it across the 25-yard line. Notre Dame quarterback by Rick Meyer. Meyer on target to break most Notre Dame total offensive passing records, like Joe Montana wears number three. He'll pass Montana for the Irish record with four TD passes. Bettis, 250 pounds, All-American, scored a record 20 touchdowns last season. And that offensive line, All-Americans Aaron Taylor and Justin Hall, the anchors. Bettis. And the Wolverine defense ready for him. Martin Davis making the tackle for Michigan. Here's the front seven of the Wolverine defense. Chris Hutchinson, an All-American candidate. He had 13 sacks last season. Marcus Walker, the top returning tackler at the linebacker spot. In the secondary, Corwin Brown, last year's overall tackling leader.
No surprise that the Fighting Irish come out on first down and run the football last week in the first half against Northwestern. 11 of 14 times on first down, that man Lou Holtz opted for the run.
The head official was talking to you about something.
That sometimes puts the pressure on your quarterback, too. Would Meyer's passing statistics be even better if he wasn't so predictable?
Absolutely, but Lou Holtz let it be known that if Rick Meyer returned for his senior season, he would not change his philosophy just for him.
Brooks the tailback in this set. Bettis is the upback. Brooks with his first carry, and Brooks twists his way to the 30-yard line where he's taken down by Steve Morrison and Tony Henderson.
This is what Lou Holtz wants to stay away from. These situations, now third down and about 6.5 yards, almost forced to throw the football here. Last week, Rick Meyer threw an early interception in that ball game and kept Northwestern in it in the first half. So it'll be interesting to see whether or not he goes to the air on this initial series.
Gerald wide left, Dawson wide right, I formation. Play action pass, Meyer to his tight end, Irv Smith across the middle for an Irish first down. 10-yard gain, Shawnee Peoples, the strong safety, making the stop for Michigan.
You're right down in the middle of the action, just a simple square in by the tight end. Rick Meyer looking awfully calm here in this opening series. He wants the chance to throw the football. He wants the opportunity to prove that he is a Heisman candidate.
And that play will be whistled dead, illegal procedure against Notre Dame, as apparently a trap play was on and the left guard, Aaron Taylor, moved prematurely.
Dead ball, false start, offense, repeat first down.
Al Hines, the referee today. This is a split crew, Big East and Big Ten. So now Rick Meyer facing a first and 15. Do you still run the football?
Lou Holtz probably will, but if you have faith in your quarterback, now's the time that it's a good opportunity to give him his chance.
Three wide receiver. Instead, Bettis bounces off one would-be tackler and crosses the 40 to the 41. He got 5 or 6 yards before Henderson and Morrison again combined to trip up Jerome Bettis. Bettis, 247 pounds, preseason All-American. Here's what he did against Northwestern a week ago. He needs 398 yards overall to break the Notre Dame top 20. And, of course, the irony, he is a native of Detroit, Michigan. Meyer. Going up top is Clint Johnson, and Johnson close to a first down at midfield. Alfie Burch had the coverage, and Martin Davis came to help out, but it's a 9-yard gain for Notre Dame, and Meyer 2-for-2 in the early going.
You see them giving a lot of respect to Clint Johnson on the outside. Alfie Birch allowing him to make the throw across the field. In college football, don't forget the hash marks are wider. So that was a long throw for an 8 or 9 yard gain on that play. But already Lou Holtz showing a lot of confidence in Rick Meyer.
There's Coach Holtz. His son Skip is the offensive coordinator and said he was hoping for more balance in the Notre Dame offense today. So far they've shown it. First down at midfield. First down pass. Meyer hits Lake Dawson. Fumble. And Michigan has it. Marcus Walker recovers the fumble after Lake Dawson had a Notre Dame first down. It was Alfie Birch who made the hit to knock the ball loose.
A big mistake last week to open the game for Notre Dame, and here once again, nice throw by Meyer. Lake Dawson hit by Alfie Birch. The ball comes free. You know, this is a much different Notre Dame offense than we expected, Tom. We were basically told that they were going to run the football until it didn't work. So far, Lou Holtz showing he will throw it.
The game's first turnover by Lake Dawson. Michigan's ball when we come back. A look at the house Rockne built. Notre Dame Stadium. Sold out. Well over 100 straight here at Notre Dame, and Michigan going with a no huddle on their first possession. Here back hands to tailback Ricky Powers, who breaks a tackle and bursts across the 45 to the 47-yard line. Greg Lay made a saving tackle for Notre Dame after Powers ripped off 15 yards. No huddle offense again. Powers had 164 yards against Notre Dame last season.
And that's exactly what Lou Holtz was talking about. He said he wasn't so concerned about the number of yards that this defense gave up against Northwestern last week in the air, but he was on the ground.
Walter Smith in motion. Here back, another hand to Powers on the left side this time. Surrounded by the Notre Dame defenders, but they can't bring him down. Powers again breaks some tackles, and Greg Lane will get credit for the stop. Here are the starting lineups. The Michigan offense, led by Elvis Gerbach. He was tops in the nation in passing efficiency last year. He's thrown more touchdown passes, 54, than any other Wolverine player. Powers needs 55 yards to go over 2,000 for his career. See the offensive line. Alexander and Smith at wide receivers. Now Tyrone Wheatley is in at the tailback back spot for Michigan on 2nd and 4. McGee in motion, and Gerbach's first pass. Flag down. Gerbach will scramble. Taken down at the Notre Dame 45, short of a first down. McGill on the stop for Notre Dame. And McGee may have been moving forward before the snap of the ball. Let's see. Illegal motion against the Wolverines. It was McGee who had been in motion and turned upfield too soon. Here's the front seven on that Notre Dame defense. Devon McDonald had a great game against Michigan last season. He had 15 tackles. Bursich second to DuBose in tackles last year. He moves into the spot vacated when DuBose was suspended. Secondary, Tom Carter, Jeff Burris. The people to watch for there. Carter playing with a slight injury. Made a saving stop against Northwestern at the goal line, knocking a pass down a week ago. Alexander and Smith. Two dangerous wide receivers in the game with Malvo. Again, McGee in motion. This is a draw play to Wheatley. And Notre Dame not fooled. A gain of only one or two before the stop is made by a host of blue-shirted Irish defenders. The ball might have come loose. Sorting it out. And it will be Michigan's ball still, but they'll face a third down, third and long.
Take a look at the play here and see if, in fact, this ball does come loose. Tyrone Wheatley, number 6, one of the fastest players in college football. The ball is on the ground, and I don't even see a fumble at all.
No tailbacks in the game. Leggett is the only setback. Three wides, Malvo, Smith, and Alexander. rolling and has plenty of time. Fires complete. Walter Smith split the defenders. Gerback, with no pressure whatsoever, finds him for 13 yards and a Michigan first down.
Don't forget, last year, Gerback started this ballgame in the first half going 12 for 14 for 101 yards. Watch the poise of Gerback. Gets wide, his receiver down the field, not there, comes back, throws across the grain, typically a dangerous pass. But Gerback looks like his arm strength has improved over a year ago, able to get it in.
Ryan Rattigan made the tackle for Notre Dame, but Michigan on the move. First down, Irish territory, the 38. Howard, cutback. Loose ball.
They're saying Notre Dame. No. Michigan football.
Michigan. The recovery, I think, made by Steve Everett or maybe Doug Skeen as they unstack them. Gary Moeller's team almost committing a critical turnover.
Here's a situation where Ricky Powers really doesn't hit the ground, but he lands on top of other players and his forward momentum was stopped. A good call by the officials.
So it'll be second down for the Wolverines. Powers has carried three times for 23 yards. Here's his fourth carry. Not much there. Notre Dame able to stack it up. Devon McDonald, with help from Jim Flanagan, able to corral Ricky Powers that time. And of course, that Notre Dame defense missing an All-American. Let's go to John Dockery for that report.
And their captain, Demetrius DeBose, I know you're watching. Anything different here from Michigan, or pretty much what you expect?
Exactly what I expected. I believe Michigan was going to just come out and run some zone plays against us. And then on second and on four and on waist downs, they probably could try to go deep on us, which they tried to do right there in the last couple of plays. But everything's pretty vintage Michigan. Hopefully our defense can go out and just stop it and control the football game.
Tom, to you, and then we'll come back.
Incomplete pass. Gerbach for Malvo. Take it back, Doc.
A simple crossing pattern by Michigan. Gerbach a little high with the pass. A fourth down situation now. This would be a field goal of almost 50 yards. And it looks like Gary Moeller may decide to just go for it.
So Moeller elects to go for it on fourth down. Remember, it was a key fourth down completion by Gerbach to Desmond Howard that sealed the win over Notre Dame last year. Fourth down and five. The catch, but was out of bounds, and Notre Dame will take over.
The play makes absolutely no sense whatsoever. He clearly would have come down out of bounds anyway, but even if he had caught the ball in bounds, not enough for the first down. A poorly designed play.
Elvis Gerbach and Gary Moeller discussing that failed fourth down play, the pass that was caught out of bounds as Moeller reacted as the play unfolded. And not happy with the result. I don't think Gerbach was too happy either. Was there some sort of mix-up?
It looked like Feldman Malvo, the wide receiver, may have blown it. Watch him. Gerbach is going to hold up three fingers. Traditionally, in the pass tree, three means an out route of about 10 to 12 yards. That time, Malvo cut his route off to about six.
Notre Dame takes over. Meyer has hit all three of his passes so far. Bettis, nothing in the middle. Stacked up by the center of the Michigan defense. Chris Hutchinson, the All-American candidate, number 97 at the bottom of the stack, the senior from Houston.
Well, the story is developing in this ballgame that Notre Dame cannot run the football. We've seen it so far. He's tried to force the run on first down time after time. Now three out of four first down calls have been runs, and Michigan has stuffed it nearly every time.
Second and eight for the Irish. No score. First quarter, 7:49 left. Play action pass. Meyer with a bullet complete to Johnson. Clint Johnson has a first down to the Notre Dame 45-yard line, 10-yard gain before he's knocked to the turf by Corbin Brown and Coleman Wallace.
Tom, we're seeing a case here where Notre Dame and Lou Holtz is clearly into plan B. And when you've got a quarterback like Rick Meyer, why not? Just a simple slant route. Clint Johnson coming up with the play. Those patterns are going to be there. Michigan's first goal this afternoon, we were told by Lloyd Carr, the defensive coordinator, is to stop the run. Now Rick Meyer gets his opportunity to throw it.
And Notre Dame takes a timeout. As they were running out of time on the play clock, and the Irish have to spend a timeout here in the first quarter. Clock shows 7 minutes, 22 seconds remaining in the opening period from Notre Dame Stadium. Rick Meyer off to a hot start, hitting his first four passes. We're scoreless at Notre Dame. Two teams have played on scoreless terms thus far in the first quarter. Notre Dame with a turnover its first possession. Michigan failing on a fourth down attempt. Skip Holtz wanted balance in the offense. He's got it. Dead even. Four passes, four runs. Durbach pumps once and goes long. Miller can't get there. Shawnee Peoples was beaten on the play as Mike Miller, the speedster on this Notre Dame team, and Meyer just overshooting his target.
Tom, that's a play that's just so hard to time out because you have the pump fake. You're used to looking at Mike Miller running at full speed throughout the course of his pattern, and more often than not, you will see a quarterback overthrow this pass. They get a little bit anxious, and that's exactly what happened. You see Mike Miller totally distraught. He knew he had a touchdown.
A rare thing, a long pass on first down for Notre Dame. Stopped after a gain of about 6 yards. Coleman Wallace and Corwin Brown. It usually takes two to bring down Jerome Bettis, and they did the trick. There's a look at Corwin Brown, the senior free safety from Chicago.
Now, Corwin Brown told me a couple of days ago that his big goal in this game was to get a big hit on Mike Miller, the speedster from Notre Dame. And he wanted to slow that guy down a little. He watched him against Northwestern. Didn't want him running by him.
Corwin Brown, second team All Big Ten selection a year ago, started every game for the Wolverines. Third down play. Meyer will scramble. He's got room and a first down. Rick Meyer bouncing to the outside, just short of the 30-yard line. Finally taken down by Coleman Wallace after he rambled for 16 yards.
That Rick Meyer gives you. Not only did he throw for 2,000 yards a year ago, but he also had 9 rushing touchdowns. He got some good work down the field from Reggie Brooks, who stayed all over Marcus Walker, allowing Meyer to pick up the first down. And you have a quarterback that can take off and pick up the first down.
Senior from Goshen, Indiana, former Indiana High School Player of the Year, a Michigan fan growing up. Hand to Brooks. Brooks to the outside. One man to beat, and he's taken down at the 20. The one man, Shawnee Peoples, made the great open field tackle. But Notre Dame continues to move the ball. There's another first down.
Reggie Brooks told us that he doesn't mind all the attention that Jerome Bettis gets. That, in fact, almost every defensive player is constantly watching for number 6, which gives him an opportunity to run free.
Reggie Brooks moving into his own. He switched numbers. He was 41 a year ago, now 40, the same number worn by his brother Tony last year and the same number worn by their dad Raymond at Booker T. Washington in Tulsa. That is Brooks' favorite play, the counter. Here's the option. Brooks on the pitch. Hit. Brooks free.
May have been knocked unconscious for a moment right at the goal line. One of the most spectacular runs you are ever going to see. Just watch and enjoy. Corwin Brown missing the tackle, nearly down another time, keeps his feet. Now watch right here at the goal line. Hit right on the helmet and literally lost consciousness for a moment, lost the football. Fortunately for him, he was in the end zone. A huge ovation and well-deserved.
Spectacular run by Reggie Brooks. What balance. And now Hendrick, Frank Hendrick on to attempt the extra point. And it's good. Well, Reggie Brooks, only 5'8". He prefers to watch football games on television. When he comes to the game and people stand up, he can't see. What a great run.
Remember, he told us that Barry Sanders was his idol. He got a chance to meet him one day, and he said, Barry, do you know who you are? Well, right here, Reggie Brooks doing his best imitation of Barry Sanders. Outstanding football play. Watch the hit.
Stunned, he still manages to stumble across the goal line, and the Irish break on top 7-0.
Radio Shack is America's number one electronic store. And with more than 80 antennas and hundreds of accessories, Radio Shack is America's number one antenna store, too. When you buy a SuperColor Special TV antenna, Radio Shack has everything you need to make installation easy. SuperColor's advanced technology gives you the clearest picture and sound possible.
Hey, great picture, huh, Howie?
Two great antenna values starting at only $24.88, just in time for football. Nobody compares to Radio Shack, America's technology store.
It begins at dawn. They've come for you. And they want what you have. It's your bed. You're sort of a perfect sleeper. But it's the most comfortable spot in the house. The Serta surface and support only Serta builds in makes it that way. So if it gets a little late for breakfast, there's always brunch. Is it any wonder people are saying, I want my Serta?
A test drive, 6 miles on smooth roads. If I was only driving 6 miles on smooth roads, I'd buy a bike. I'd get in shape. Let me test drive in rush hour traffic so I can see if it'll last like a Subaru. Let me test drive it to snowy Alaska so I can see if it has all-wheel drive like a Legacy. Don't take me around the block. Let's get it to 50 and slam the brakes so I can see if it offers anti-lock brakes like a Legacy. Test drives aren't real. What's real is the money I'm spending. Show me. Tell me. I have the money. I want to know what to drive.
Burger King has a deal that's really making some noise. Every time you buy a Whopper meal, you get a 16-ounce Coke glass free. That's a flame broil Whopper sandwich, medium Coca-Cola Classic, medium fries, and a Coke glass free. Sounds sweet, huh? Collect the whole set and you'll be seriously jamming. Not to mention the tasty fringe benefits.
I heard that.
Your way, right away.
The Bills, Jim Kelly, and the NFL's top offensive machine have reached the Super Bowl 2 years running. The 49ers, they've made the playoffs 8 times in the last 9 years. Now, two NFL powerhouses air it out. Part of an NBC football doubleheader, Sunday.
One of the great scenes in college football, Notre Dame Stadium sold out for the 101st straight time. That view coming from the Goodyear Blimp Spirit, based in Akron, Ohio. Goodyear, the nation's oldest tire company. Glad to have the Goodyear Blimp with us this afternoon. Here's Hendrick's kickoff after the Notre Dame score. Taken in the end zone by Wheatley. Tyrone Wheatley lowers his head and makes it to about the 19-yard line. He'll be marked out of bounds, I guess, at about the 17. Let's take another look at that touchdown run by Reggie Brooks.
Don't forget, this drive was kept alive by Meyer's 16-yard run on 3rd and 4, the option game. And this was the play that Lloyd Carr, the defensive coordinator of Michigan, was scared to death about. He said, Meyer can throw it. They have great backs in Bettis and Brooks, and then they can also run the option. That's spectacular. That really is just spectacular.
I haven't seen a run like that for many seasons. That was perfect balance, perfect presence of mind, despite the staggering hit at the goal line. Michigan tries to answer. And the Irish defense ready for that one. Junior Bryant. Jim Flanagan stopping Bernie Leggett for a short game.
The Notre Dame offense now has picked up 111 yards on 13 plays, 8.5 yards per play. And don't forget, the only time the Irish have been stopped in this game so far was on Lake Boston's fumble.
Stopped themselves on that occasion. Jesse Johnson in a tailback now, the junior from Harper Woods, Michigan. And he gets the call. Devon McDonald makes the stop for Notre Dame. Let's get back now to John Dockery with Demetrius Dubose. Doc?
Thank you, Tom. Demetrius, you spent some time with Pete Gersich during the week. What did you tell him before the game?
Well, I just told Pete to be confident, and then I knew that Michigan would come out and run a lot of trailer to tie in, and I told him just to be poised and be confident in his calls and his decisions, and that would make everybody relax around him.
You know, I know you have enormous emotional feelings. Can you share those with us sitting here rather than being in the game?
Well, it's tough. You know, I just, before the game, I just told all my teammates that I loved them and I cared about them. And it really means a lot for me to be able to play in the Michigan game. But, you know, it's an unfortunate situation, but hopefully next week I'll be back and be ready to play.
There's a completion, Tom.
Was indeed, Doc, a completion from Elvis Gerback to Walter Smith on a third down. It covered 20 yards, and Michigan in business now, moving the football with a first down.
I want to tell you something. Elvis Gerback has really improved his arm strength in the offseason. This ball is a bullet to Walter Smith. Boy, we're seeing two outstanding college quarterbacks here this afternoon.
Living up to advanced billing.
Wow.
Michigan staying with the no huddle, a formation, an offense that really didn't fear, strike any fear in the Notre Dame defenders. Not much there for Tyrone Wheatley on that carry from tailback. The Notre Dame defensive staff saying that Michigan uses the no huddle not so much as a hurry up, and you have plenty of time to make substitutions. They don't really snap it in a hurry. They still use their allotted time. And there's Rick Minter, the new defensive coordinator for the Notre Dame Fighting Irish, who said he looked to install a more aggressive Notre Dame defense this season.
Yeah, and Rick also said that he wants this defense to be counted on to win football games, not just always be the unit that is breaking down.
Second down, Gerback retreats. And again, completes the pass across the middle to Derek Alexander. Anthony Peterson tackles him immediately. And the Wolverines finding room in the seams in the middle of the Notre Dame pass defense.
Michigan now getting back to what they did effectively a year ago, and that's use the short ball control type of passing game and use it on the early downs. Now they've got themselves a third and three situation for Notre Dame, probably a running down, but for Michigan, you expect them to throw.
Leggett is the only setback. Down the sideline. And complete. Walter Smith coming back to the ball. Flags down. It looked like Notre Dame interference, but Smith fought off the early contact and came back to make the reception ahead of John Covington.
What a great catch by Walter Smith. Not only in a clutch situation, but John Covington was absolutely all over him. Refused to let him pull his arms away. Goes up and makes a big play. Nice play by Walter Smith.
Smith, a redshirt sophomore from Detroit, had a 9-yard touchdown reception in the Rose Bowl. His best day came against Minnesota last season when he had 5 catches, and his first career grab was against the Irish of Notre Dame.
Pass interference, defense, 15 yards from the previous spot, first down.
You're getting a situation where you have a safety and John Covington in man-to-man coverage with Walter Smith. That was a mismatch. Covington knew it. And almost amazing the way he was able to hang on to the football. Literally got one hand over the top while the other arm was being stripped by his side. That's a great catch. That really is.
It goes for 20 yards. They'll refuse the interference penalty and take over just inside the Irish 35-yard line. Michigan with a first down. Elvis Gerback has hit 4 of 6 for 58 yards.
I think Rick Minner was surprised that Michigan threw the football on that last down. They went with the man-to-man coverage.
Reverse. Alexander. Only a gain of one. Tom Carter had to contain, and he contained it well. They were ready for the reverse by Alexander.
Tom Carter ultimately made the play, but it was John Covington who just had the interference call against him, number 29, that really slowed it down to begin with. You see, he made the receiver slow down, made him stop. Derek Alexander had to wait for some help, and by that time, the pursuit got there.
Alexander in motion. Powers. Bryant Young was the man who made the initial contact. Bryant Young, the junior from Chicago Heights, Illinois, a friend of Michigan player Marcus Walker since his high school days, stood Powers up and enabled the pursuit to take him down.
Without question, Notre Dame's best defensive lineman, watch him, number 97, Bryant Young. He is their All-American candidate on that defensive line. Lou Holtz says that he has the opportunity to be as good as anybody that has ever played here.
Ninth play of the drive coming up. It's a third and nine. The box pass to a wide open Walter Smith, who can't handle it. Now Moeller, disappointed with that malfunctioning play, went for it on fourth down earlier. Will he go for it here? Fourth and nine from the Irish 34, trailing 7-0 and only 4 seconds left in the opening quarter. And they will kick it.
Well, you know, he got burned last time. He goes for it on fourth down, leaves Notre Dame in good field position, which ultimately turned into an Irish touchdown. This time, decides to play for field position.
Eddie Ascona will punt for the Wolverines. Notre Dame has nobody deep. Trying to angle it out of bounds. They'll line it up, and let's see where they mark it. There's the official with his hand in the air as they try to line it up, and he's heading in the wrong direction as far as the Wolverines are concerned. He'll stop at about the 15-yard line, where the Irish will take over after a 19-yard punt. Notre Dame's ball to start the second quarter, leading 7-0. Elvis Gerbach on the phone to the coaches upstairs. His offense has moved the ball, but when they get close to scoring territory, twice they have sputtered.
Tom, last week against Northwestern, Notre Dame only had the football 9 times, only 3 in the first half, but they certainly did take advantage of it. 5 scoring drives of 80 yards or more, already a scoring drive of 67 yards here this afternoon. If they're to get it in here, though, about 85 yards worth.
Two most successful programs in college football history on a gorgeous afternoon in South Bend. Miller in the flat, trying to break it. Finally covered by the Michigan defense, led by Alfie Birch. Mike Miller was the man of great expectations. He's out of Missouri City, Texas. He came to Notre Dame billed as the next Rocket, Rocket Ishmael. But he wasn't happy in his first year last season at Notre Dame. He played in one game. It was against Michigan. Then he left school. He went to the University of Houston. Never played football there, but while he was in Houston, changed his mind, called the coaches here at Notre Dame, asked to return, and is here on the team. Jerome Bettis has a Notre Dame first down across the 25-yard line with Marcus Walker hanging on for dear life.
This game plan, really a total surprise. You're seeing Lou Holtz throwing the football on first down almost exclusively. We talked to Skip Holtz, Lou's son, yesterday, and he said Lou's favorite words are second and six. That's all he wants, 4 yards on first down, and that he prefers to throw it or to run it to get it.
He told his dad, Lou, that Skip wanted more play-action passes, and Lou's response was, look at Becton. Lou Becton breaking tackles, and he has another first down across the 40. Colin Brown finally able to wrestle him down, and Martin Davis helping out as well. That is a 14-yard gain.
You're going to see Aaron Taylor pull across the line of scrimmage and kick out the end. That's what opened the play up for Lee Becton.
Becton, a sophomore out of North Carolina, with a first down run, and Notre Dame continues to move the football on the Michigan defense. Becton again. Tripped up, stumbles forward for a gain of a yard or two. It was Chris Hutchinson that knocked the feet out from under Lee Becton. There's Hutchinson. All-American candidate, academic All-American candidate, as a matter of fact. He was on the All-Big Ten academic team last year. He has a 3.23 grade point average in movement science. That's kinesiology.
Yeah, he's the captain of this defensive football team as well. Was also named Freshman Defensive Lineman of the Year in 1989.
Complete pass to Bettis. Bettis shows the capability of receiving out of the backfield. He'll be a yard short of a first down. Walker and Wallace double teamed him to the turf. And there is Lou Holtz. We were talking about how his son Skip wants him to open up and pass more. And when we told Lou that Skip wanted more play action passes against Michigan, he said, yeah, Skip wanted to drive when he was 8 years old too, but he wasn't ready. But it looks like he has heeded his son's advice today.
I don't know if he came into this ball game with that plan, but almost by necessity, based on the way that Michigan's defense was able to stuff the run in the first quarter.
Michigan now beefing up its offensive line on this third down play. Burris is in on the offense. He was in on a goal line situation for Notre Dame against Northwestern. Tony Henderson and Steve Morrison combining on the stop there, but not before Notre Dame picks up another first down.
We talked about Notre Dame's defense at the top of the show, but maybe the key is Michigan's defense because of this powerful offense of Notre Dame. They really have not stopped the Fighting Irish yet.
There's a look at Skip Holtz, the offensive coordinator and the son of head coach Lou Holtz. I asked Skip what he called his dad, and he said, Coach Holtz. And I said, well, what do they call you? He says, Coach Skip. That's Irv Smith. Breaking too early, and that'll be a 5-yard step off against the Irish.
False start.
You know, Irv Smith as a tight end, as an eligible receiver there, could have reestablished himself. If he had not gone across the line and made contact, it looked like he just gave up on the play, but he is an eligible receiver. So now if he comes back and resets and nobody from Michigan jumps, I believe that that's a perfectly legal play. The referees were very late on the call, really did not blow the whistle until he gave up on it.
So Clint Johnson and Mike Miller, along with Lake Dawson, three wide receivers in the game for Notre Dame on first and 15. And a first down pass. Meyer on the look in to Lake Dawson. And Dawson, who fumbled earlier in the game after a 15-yard pickup, takes this one. He'll be short of the first down as he's tackled by Coleman Wallace.
I don't know that I'm really believing what I'm seeing. We sat in the room with Lou Holtz yesterday, and he almost scoffed at us when we brought up the possibility that maybe he should throw more on first down than what he did last week against Northwestern. Maybe Skip Holtz is winning the battle of the Holtz family.
What did he tell you? Teams that pitch and catch don't beat anybody? Is that what he said to you?
That was his quote.
Bettis stopped in his tracks, and this may be why they're throwing the ball. It's because Michigan is daring Notre Dame to beat him with a pass while stopping Bettis on the ground. That was Henderson and Walker, and they've been tough up the middle on Bettis today.
Now maybe now it's time for Notre Dame to get away from trying to run it right up the middle and flip it outside, give Jerome Bettis a little room to roam on the outside. Skip Holtz told us yesterday that he has as good a hands as anybody on this football team. They would love to get him the ball away from the line of scrimmage because he is absolutely intimidating to defensive backs once he breaks free.
Bettis on the sideline, held in check. This is the ninth play of the drive, and it's third down. Meyer has it batted in the air and almost intercepted. It was Steve Rutkowski, the junior from Redford, Michigan, that knocked the ball into the air and almost had a chance to grab it for the interception. So the Michigan defense putting the pressure on Meyer that time.
Really not. Meyer just hit Rutkowski in the head. He never even saw it coming. Watch number 66, a nice job of blocking in the middle. Aaron Taylor making a nice block, and then boom, hit him right off the shoulder pads. He threw up his arms to fool us. I think that's a good idea. Probably get credit for knocking down the pass.
But we went for it. Here's Alexander awaiting the punt by Hendrick. A very poor snap by Johnson, the long snapper. And the ball will reach the end zone on the fly for the touchback. The Wolverines will take over at their own 20-yard line, trailing Notre Dame 7-0. Tom Hammond, Chris Collinsworth, John Dockery at Notre Dame Stadium. Fighting Irish leading the Wolverines of Michigan 7-0. 9:58 left in the first half. Notre Dame ranked third in the nation. Michigan, depending on which poll you take, ranked either fifth or sixth. Sixth in the AP poll. And Michigan will have the ball at its own 20-yard line. Here are the Wolverines after huddling with Coach Gary Moeller. And in the center of that line, Elvis Gerback will take the snap from Steve Everett, the All-American candidate from Miami, Florida. He wears number 51. His home with his parents destroyed in Hurricane Andrew. His father's a sculptor, his studio destroyed as well. His parents living in one livable room of their former home in Miami now. Gerback sets up a screen and completes it to Johnson. And the Notre Dame defense, much maligned, but ready for the task so far today. They collapse on that screen, and Rick Minter telling us that Michigan runs a tremendous amount of reverses and screens, and he had his defenders ready for that one.
Yeah, going back to that Steve Everett story, so many families, of course, devastated by Hurricane Andrew. Steve said his parents literally spent 4 hours in the bathroom because the roof and the windows had all blown away. A very scary situation for him. Said he hasn't had much of an opportunity to talk to them. They were originally supposed to be here in town for this one, but obviously could not.
Delayed handoff. Johnson. And again, stopped after a short gain. Give credit that time to Jim Flanagan, the junior from Sturgeon Bay, Wisconsin, leading the defensive charge for Notre Dame. And one final note about Steve Everett, the Michigan center. He calls his parents about every other day. They have to go to a payphone to get the call. And remember last year in the game against Notre Dame, he had his jaw broken on a hit by Pete Bursich. It was gruesome. He left the field, carried to the hospital. The Wolverines leading 17-0. He looked at the TV when he came to at the hospital. It was 17-14. He said, oh, no, not again. But the Wolverines held on to win. You're back on third down. Wide open completion to Alexander. And Derek Alexander with a Wolverine first down to the 42-yard line. Jeff Burris trips him up, but Alexander wide open takes it for 21 yards.
Boy, they are so happy to have that young man, Derek Alexander, back in the lineup this year. Last year suffered a knee injury, was supposed to be teamed with Desmond Howard. You see him running just a tremendous route on the best cornerback for the Fighting Irish, and that is Tom Carter. He's an All-American candidate, but Alexander completely turning him around that time.
Second catch by Alexander, who had a medical redshirt year last year after a knee injury in the first game against Boston College.
Look out.
Jesse Johnson down the sideline, knocked out of bounds by Jeff Burris, but he carries it into Notre Dame territory, and Michigan with another first down, 24-yard gain.
Watch the middle of your screen. Steve Everett going for a position, and he gets it. That's all you need, and he stayed with it. So many times you'll see an offensive lineman make good initial contact but not stay with the block. That time Steve Everett did, and that's the reason he's considered an All-American candidate.
First-rate block by Steve Everett. Rob Doherty made a nice one, too. First down, Michigan, moving at the Irish 36. Johnson. Jesse Johnson to the 30-yard line. Bryant Young and John Covington double-teaming him, getting him down finally. And we told you about the hit by Bursich a year ago that broke the jaw of Steve Everett. Here it is.
This is one of the most gruesome plays you're going to see in football. Watch number 47. That's Pete Bursich right in the middle of your screen. He is going to hit Steve Everett right here. His helmet completely or almost completely destroyed, broke his jaw, said when they were trying to lay him on the stretcher, blood was literally running down his throat. He couldn't breathe. Thought he was going to drown in his own blood.
Gerback completes it to Tony McGee as tight end. Knocked out of bounds just short of the 20-yard line. It's enough for another Michigan first down. McGill and Carter on the stop of big Tony McGee, 241 pounds from Terre Haute, Indiana. Here's the end of that play from a year ago where Everett had his jaw broken.
Couldn't really see it there, but he said literally his jaw was broken in half, and the only thing that kept it in his mouth was his cheek, but it was literally just laying there on the side of his face.
Enough of that. You told that story the other day over breakfast, I might add, which was not very pleasant. Jesse Johnson. He's been the workhorse. We haven't seen as much of Powers as we expected. It's been Jesse Johnson, the junior from Harper Islands, Michigan, from Harper Woods, Michigan, that has done the bulk of the ground game for the Wolverines. Second quarter, Notre Dame Stadium, 6:58 and counting. The Notre Dame Fighting Irish leading Michigan 7-0, but the Wolverines on the move. Michigan moving the ball for the best time so far in the game, facing a 2nd and 7 from the Irish 17. Again, it's Johnson. Again, Johnson does a good job before he's thrown back for the Notre Dame defense. That's the 6th carry of the game by Jesse Johnson. By contrast, Ricky Powers has 5 carries of the football.
Well, defensively, Notre Dame's been doing a nice job all day long. This is the most effective drive of the ball game for Michigan. And you see Greg Lane doing a nice job not allowing him to fall forward. When you get down this close to the goal line, you have to drive that running back the other way, because now we're down to a key situation.
3rd and 2. And that'll be a 5-yard step off against Michigan. So the Wolverines, with a key 3rd and 2, commit a big mistake. And now Moeller says, let's try to get it back. It was Sean Miller, the guard, that jumped too soon. And then a host of Wolverines called for a legal procedure.
This is just absolute death. When you get down inside the 15-yard line, you only need 2 yards. You're running behind your best offensive lineman on the right side. Doherty, Kokozo, Everett, McGee over there. Almost impossible to stop. Now you put yourself in a passing situation.
Don't forget, this is Michigan's first game, so likely they'll commit some of those timing mistakes. Nickel defense for Notre Dame, 3 wides for Michigan. Gerback for the end zone. Tom Carter, the veteran defender for Notre Dame, with the interception. The pass intended for Alexander, and Carter makes a big play.
Elvis Gerback, who played so flawlessly a year ago, makes a huge mistake. Tom Carter atones for his earlier getting beat by Derek Alexander. Boy, that is close. I'm not sure this ball was intercepted or not. See if we can get a little better angle of it. You see Tom Carter go up, make the play. Does he ever have possession? Looked like he did. He flipped over and had it.
Leading interceptor a year ago, Tom Carter. First pickoff of the 92 season.
A poor read by Elvis Gerback, number 2. Walter Smith wide open on this play for the first down. Gerback decides to go into the end zone for Derek Alexander. And now there will be no field goal, no 3 points. Watch the reaction. They love it.
First turnover caused by the Notre Dame defense this season. They didn't have one against Northwestern a week ago. Irish offense on the field now. Meyer looks one way, the other, back to the right. And now we'll scramble. Nice move by Meyer and out of bounds. Did you see the move he put on the defender? Faked the pass even though he was beyond the line of scrimmage. He knew he couldn't throw it. But the defender bent and Meyer had an extra 5 or 6 yards.
You see him scrambling around a la Joe Montana. Hard not to say that name when you're watching number three. Really across the line of scrimmage at the time that he made the fake, but Martin Davis went for it anyway and allowed him to scamper up the sideline.
Reggie Brooks back on for the Irish. Bruised his shoulder on the spectacular touchdown run earlier, but back on the field and getting the handoff. Spins away from tacklers. Brooks still on his feet. What a run. 45-yard line. Here's another Irish star in the making today, Reggie Brooks. He spun away from Steve Rutkowski, kept his balance, and he is spectacular today.
You know what's happening? This defense is really focusing in on Jerome Bettis. Bettis that time goes to the right, a simple counterplay back to the left. Tom, you said before the broadcast that you thought Reggie Brooks was going to end up being the star on this team. You may be right.
First down Irish. They've gained 185 yards so far. Bettis, not to be outdone by Reggie Brooks, takes Steve Morrison for a ride on his back and takes about 7 yards off that chain for Notre Dame.
That was a highlight play in itself. You will only see a handful of fullbacks anywhere in football that is able to hit into the line of scrimmage, slide 3 or 4 yards to the right, and still pick up 6 yards. There's some talent on this field.
Just over 4 minutes left in the first half. Notre Dame leading Michigan 7-0. Myers pass overshoots Adrian Gerald, the intended receiver. Well, the two defenses, Chris, have been blitzed by these high-powered offenses today. They've been bending, although not breaking, with only 7 points scored. Michigan defense has surrendered nearly 200 yards. Notre Dame has given up 157 to the Michigan offense.
Yeah, and I think I've seen just about everything now. On a second down and two call, Lou Holtz comes up with a pass. This is just not typical Lou Holtz football.
Let's see if they go back to their familiar power game. They're in the I formation. Brooks is the tailback. Reggie Brooks, good blocking up front. Brooks knocks down the official and takes another Dame first down. Shawnee Peoples made the tackle for Michigan. Brooks not happy about that. He thought he needed more, and the official kind of got in the way.
Well, the umpire shouldn't feel too badly. Reggie Brooks has been knocking down everybody else. Another nice move. They go with the draw play. This is a much more wide open game plan by Lou Holtz here this afternoon.
Irish first down. Clock shows 3:54 first half. Notre Dame at the Michigan 43. Becton. Lee Becton, who's coming at tailback for Brooks, has 11 yards. Dean Lytle made a block out of the backfield to spring him, and Corwin Brown sees the Irish running game net another first.
So many times in college football, you just don't know who the star is going to be. Willie Clark, a young man who has just so much talent, so fast, under 4.3 in the 40-yard dash, but he has a broken wrist and is playing with a bit of a fiberglass cast. May or may not get in the ball game today, so that means that Lee Becton gets his opportunity, and he's certainly taking advantage of it.
It's Lytle and Becton in the backfield here on a first down play. Becton. Lee Becton twisting and turning to the Wolverine 20 with Corwin Brown and Dwayne Ware wrapped around his ankles. Lee Becton getting into the act. Everybody off the bench for the Irish today is executing the offense. Becton has carried 4 times for 39 yards.
And we also may have another story developing. Chris Hutchinson, the great defensive lineman from Michigan, limping off the field. And Aaron Taylor, number 75, looked like he was awfully happy about it. Literally tapping him on the tail and saying, all right, go over to the sideline, get out of here. I've seen enough of you already.
Gannon Duglar, a 6'4", 265-pound junior from Birmingham, Michigan, replaces Hutchinson. Becton, nothing there this time. Tony Henderson met him first, and then Duglar, who just came in, put the finishing touches on Lee Becton. Clock continues to roll, now under 3 minutes.
Tony Henderson had a good year as a redshirt freshman last season, 37 tackles and 3 sacks for the Wolverines. Interesting to see where they go now. I'm trying to guess with Lou Holtz. You would almost have to say pass now. Traditionally, maybe a run, maybe a draw, but the way Rick Meyer's throwing the football, you look for the pass here.
They've had only one pass on this drive. This will be a reverse and a fumbled football that Michigan recovers. Martin Davis got right in the middle of that play. They couldn't make a clean exchange of the ball, and when it came loose, Martin Davis, the senior from Chesapeake, Virginia, was there to recover for the Wolverines. Second Notre Dame turnover. Both times they seem to be driving for a possible score.
Tom, I really don't like this call. When you're down this close, you're putting yourself in a position where you almost have an automatic 3 points. And when you run a reverse play, you take a chance on either a fumble or a big loss. Even if Notre Dame had been able to recover this ball, they would have been out of field goal range. I think that's a bad call.
The famous Notre Dame Golden Dome reflecting the September sunshine as we look down from the Goodyear blimp Spirit. One of Goodyear's other blimps, Stars and Stripes, is currently in South Florida providing disaster relief information via its computerized message board. I'm glad to have Spirit with us today. That's the Notre Dame Stadium. A scaled down version of the Michigan Stadium, which seats 102,000. Notre Dame's over 59,000, but Michigan's built in 1927, and Notre Dame using the same basic plans with some input from Newt Rockne to build this facility 1930.
2:19 to go now. Let's see what Gerback can do with this 2-minute offense. It won't be the slow no huddle. This is the hurry up tempo now.
Gerback with time and an open receiver, Tony McGee. McGee with a first down, stopped at the 49-yard line by Anthony Peterson, a 16-yard gain. Gerback to McGee.
We're seeing a lot of man-to-man coverage in the secondary for Notre Dame. That time Anthony Peterson locked up on Tony McGee. Simply not able to get him covered. Really had a lot of field to work with on the top of your screen and was able to take advantage of Anthony Peterson.
First down play for Michigan, trailing Notre Dame 7-0, 2 minutes and counting. Gerback in traffic, but the catch made. Again, big Tony McGee, the tight end. Let's go down to John Dockery now for an update on the injury to Michigan defender Chris Hutchinson.
You know, it's good news for Michigan. Chris Hutchinson, as you can see, is behind me. He's on the bench. He's fine. His leg is fine. But interesting listening to Greg Mathison, the defensive line coach, talk to his defensive team. He made a very dramatic statement, Tom. He said, look, if we do our assignments, if we tackle, if we get to the ball, we can beat this team. We have them beaten.
Gerback rolling out. And his pass right on the money to Derek Alexander. Beautiful execution by Gerback and Alexander. It went for 18 yards, and suddenly with its 2-minute drill, the Wolverines moving the football down the field.
The exact same play that they hit earlier. This is just a deep comeback route by Derek Alexander. Tom Carter certainly showing Derek Alexander a lot of respect, giving him a big cushion, as is generally the case when you have under 2 minutes to go in a half. We shall see if this layback and bend but don't break defense is effective for Notre Dame here before the half.
Jesse Johnson in a tailback now as Gerback again goes to the air in the flat intended for Johnson, but over his head and incomplete. Gerback now has hit 10 of 15 in the game for 129 yards. He had the interception in the end zone.
Now, Elvis Gerback certainly has been a great quarterback for Michigan. During the course of his career and the games that he has started, they have a record of 23-5.
If you're wondering about his name, he is of Croatian descent. Elvis is a common name in Croatian. He's still with relatives in that war-torn country, newly independent from Yugoslavia. One punt from Gerback. And across the middle, knocked down. Pretty defensive play by Anthony Peterson. McGee, the tight end in the center of the field, the intended target, but Peterson timed it perfectly to bat it away.
Boy, that's a nice play right there by Anthony Peterson. And this is what Rick Minner, the defensive coordinator of the Fighting Irish, talked about. He said, in last week's game, we gave the receivers of Northwestern too much respect. That when they come into our zone defense, we have to attack. That's exactly what Anthony Peterson did on that play.
Timeout Michigan with 107 left in the opening half. Gary Moeller has just counseled his offensive unit, trailing Notre Dame 7-0 with 1:07 left in the second quarter. Wolverines still with two timeouts remaining. Michigan with a third and 10 from the Notre Dame 28. Tyrone Wheatley in the game now, along with three wide receivers for Michigan. And it's Wheatley that gets the call. Bounces off one would-be tackler. Down the sideline, Wheatley for a touchdown.
Remember, folks, we are in South Bend. The stands have basically emptied and jumped all over Tyrone Wheatley. What a play by Wheatley coming down the sideline. He is a blur. And once he broke free, it was right down the sideline for an easy touchdown. Take a look. Gerback throws it off in the flat. A missed tackle on the play. John Covington unable to get him down. Wheatley off down the sideline as he did in high school, won the state championship in the 100 meters, 110 hurdles, and the long jump in high school.
And the extra point, Elizovic out of a hole by Reimersma. And he boots it through to tie the game. A dramatic touchdown in the last minute of the first half as Tyrone Wheatley, the sophomore from Inkster, Michigan, takes the 28-yard reception from Elvis Gerbach.
Well, I tell you, it's nice when you have athletes like that that can just make plays. That was LaRon Moore that bounced off and made the initial contact. But we have seen a lot of just simply great athletic plays.
Chris, watch the block by wide receiver Derek Alexander, too. He makes a good block after Wheatley bounces off. And I don't know if you'll see it in this view. There it is. Alexander.
More often than not, when you see a play go for the distance, somebody has made a play blocking down the field.
Gary Moeller celebrates the tying score. They've moved the football very well. In fact, now have more total yards than Notre Dame. But that's their first score of the afternoon. It goes to Tyrone Wheatley, who scored 9 touchdowns last year as a freshman, including a 53-yard run in the Rose Bowl.
You know, Tom, and here we go again with Michigan and Notre Dame. It seems that when these two teams get together, we always have a close game, hard fought, with a lot of spectacular plays.
Elizovic to kick it off. It's a squid kick. Bouncing to the Notre Dame 20. Jeff Burris collared at about the 30-yard line by Coleman Wallace. And let's see if the Irish now, with the offense that has amassed 208 yards here in the first half, can get some points in the final 53 seconds. Injured player on the play for Michigan. It's Dennis Washington.
But Tom, there's still plenty of time left here in this first half. 53 seconds. We'll find out exactly how much confidence Lou Holtz has in Rick Myers' ability to make the right decision. You don't mind so much here if you don't get points on the board, but if you truly have trust in your quarterback, you can have the faith in him that he won't make the big mistake. And that's what they want to avoid. If they get points, fine, but don't turn it over and give Michigan another chance to score and take the lead before half.
Rick Meyer totally committed to winning a national championship and an assertive leader on this Notre Dame team after passing up a chance to come out early to the NFL. And in practice, he often reprimands his players. I didn't stay around here for nothing. Hope you stay with us at halftime. Scores and highlights with Jim Lampley, Hannah Storm. And we'll see if Meyer, who has hit 7 of 10 passes, can get something on the board before intermission. Let's see if we can find out what happened on this injury to Dennis Washington.
Dennis Washington, number 24, right here. We'll see if we can. It looks like maybe a problem with his knee. He was being forced down, and you can see that knee buckle underneath. And that's one of the dangers of playing football, is that sometimes those knees are put in positions where they really don't belong. There it is, right there, as his foreleg just lays down on the ground. And you certainly hope that Dennis Washington is okay. They're still attending to him on the field.
Dr. Gerald O'Connor in the blue shirt is the knee specialist with this Michigan team, taking a look along with trainer Paul Schmidt. Well, we'll be back here at Notre Dame Stadium on the 26th for an intrastate rival as the Purdue Boilermakers will make an appearance against the Notre Dame Fighting Irish. That's coming your way on NBC on September 26th, the Irish and the Purdue Boilermakers.
Tom, this has really been an offensive show so far. Over 400 yards of offense here in the first half, and yet the score only 7-7. What we've seen is some big turnovers in the scoring zone, interceptions, fumbles, but for the most part, neither defense has been able to completely shut down the other team's offense. And this isn't so good. They're bringing out the stretcher now, so I certainly hope this young man is okay.
Dennis Washington, redshirt junior from Lorain, Ohio, and his coach Rick Mulder now coming to check on his backup fullback. This really hurts the depth factor at fullback for Michigan. They really had only two that had played extensively. Geth, the first teamer, Washington is backup. Foster, a redshirt freshman, would be the third fullback.
You know, you get so excited watching college football, and there's so much drama and the pageantry and the crowds, and it's so much fun. But this is part of the reality. There are young men who get hurt that have to go through off-season rehabilitations, but fortunately the doctors now are doing such a great job that in general these young men are able to get back in a year's time. But you see the concern on the part of their teammates. This is it's never fun.
It sort of takes the steam out of that emotional high that the Wolverines were experiencing after scoring in the final minute of the half to tie the game.
Yeah, looks like he may indeed have a bit of a problem with that knee. They've got the shoulder pads off now and applying, I believe what that is
an inflatable cast,
right, an air cast, where literally they just want to immobilize that part of the knee. I can't, you know, you hate to speculate. Maybe the knee, maybe the lower leg, tibia, the fibula down there, sometimes a problem.
Impressive reeling off that anatomy.
Medical terminology at college. Watch it one more time. Number 24, Dennis Washington. We'll see if anything beyond. Okay. I've seen that one enough.
It's the thing players fear most, isn't it? A knee injury?
Yeah, it really is. And look at him. You know, Dennis Washington here, he comes out here this afternoon so excited, so fired up to play, giving 100%. And then just the strangest things can happen. You just put your leg in a strange position, fall back over. And it's not just the Michigan players that get upset. You see both sides concerned. Aaron Taylor there initially.
Justin Hall, some of the other Notre Dame players. It's right in front, in fact, of the Notre Dame bench. And respect from the opposition.
Yeah, that's a good point. When you play in this type of a football game, you definitely have respect for the guys on the other side of the ball. Many of these young men played in all-star games together. They played against each other in high school, and certainly don't like to see this happen to anybody. Nice hand from the Notre Dame crowd as well.
Return to play with 53 seconds left in the first half. Michigan has just tied the game at 7. Notre Dame will have the ball at their own 31-yard line.
Two timeouts remaining for Notre Dame, so plenty of time to make it work. Michigan really hasn't been effective in stopping them all day. They've got the spread formation in.
And the nickel defense from Michigan. They're putting pressure on Meyer here. Johnson makes a nice catch, but it'll go only for a yard or two. Alfie Birch smacked him as soon as he made the reception.
That was a high-risk play. That was, you throw the ball high like that when Alfie Birch is closing in on your receiver, a chance for a tip ball. A lot of different things can happen. You see, Ruholtz said, all right, I tried it once. But I would imagine we're going to see a running play here.
In fact, Bettis is back in the game now. Brooks and Bettis, the split backs, as you see the clock ticking away, and Notre Dame will pass. Meyer decides to tuck it under and run. It makes a pretty nice run out of it. Just short of the 45-yard line, it's a first down, but the time ticking away, it stops now on the first down. Birch and Blankenship made the tackle for Michigan.
Yeah, and Tony Blankenship almost took his head off. Notre Dame is going to take the timeout. They've got the ball up to the 44-yard line now, which gives them an opportunity at least for the Hail Mary down the field.
So just 6 seconds now remaining in this first half. Holtz and the Irish breaking on top. Michigan with a score. Gerr back to Wheatley in the final minute to tie it. And coming up tomorrow, we'll shift gears and see the pros in action. It starts with NFL Live, 12:30 Eastern Time. Most of you will then see the Raiders playing the Bengals. Cincinnati a winner at Seattle, returning home under their young head coach, Dave Shula. Then the second game, most of you will see Buffalo and San Francisco. Should be a great game. Two teams, Chris, capable of meeting in the Super Bowl, the 49ers and the Bills.
Well, they're my pick to go to the Super Bowl this year, so you can just about eliminate those two things.
I was just about to say that. Lou Holtz. His offense has rung up 225 yards.
Wait a minute here.
And they're in the no huddle, and Michigan still over on the sideline. Notre Dame ready to go.
The officials keeping control of the situation.
And the total yards, Michigan 224, Notre Dame 225. We told you it would be a close game.
This is a bit of a surprise set. Three wide receivers to the bottom of the screen. Indeed, they are going for the Hail Mary.
Incomplete with one tick left. Michigan had it well covered.
Now that's a play you're seeing more and more teams run in this situation to try and get themselves into a position where they can actually throw it into the end zone. It was the Hail Mary type formation with the three wide receivers at the bottom of the screen, and then one of the receivers simply breaks back and tries to come underneath, that time Mike Miller. Everybody else down the field.
Michigan has called a timeout. Michigan apparently wanting to talk it over and make sure that there isn't some freak last play. Calls a timeout with 1 second left, and at last report they had six defensive backs playing that, as we said, prevent defense the whole last few series of plays. Only two men, two down linemen rushing. Jim Lampley set to take the stage at halftime to bring you up on this week in college football. He'll have all the scores and highlights coming up, and one more play barring a defensive penalty.
Yeah, and that's really the key. You cannot have defensive pass interference, because if you do, then you get another play even if the clock has expired. And I'm sure that's what Gary Moeller is telling his troops over on the sideline. And one of the comments that Gary Moeller made when we talked with him was that he had a concern about the officiating in this game. He said not only do players and coaches get caught up in the emotion of playing here at Notre Dame Stadium, but sometimes the officials do as well, and they will give Notre Dame the benefit of the doubt. So I'm sure he just told his troops to be careful.
For the last play of a half, Ray Griggs on the field for Notre Dame. Lake Dawson is there with Clint Johnson, the wide receiver. It's a draw play to Brooks. So Notre Dame playing it safe. Brooks will take it to the 45 and bring the half to an end as Chris Hutchinson made sure they got no more out of it. So Gerback, he's not an Elvis impersonator. He's the real thing. He and Meyer have squared off today and played to a 7-7 deadlock. Let's go to John Dockery.
Coach, it's a tough way to open the season here at Notre Dame, but are you generally satisfied with your team's performance?
Well, I'm satisfied to some degree with the score. Really, I'm not happy with that. We'll play better as the game goes on, because this is the first half of our first game. But I know they got an excellent football team, and we're at this point, we're fortunate to be where we're at. But I think we're going to play better the second half.
Any changes in the second half you envision?
No, I'm not going to do a lot of changing, no. I'm going to stick with basically the same thing, just do it better.
Thanks, Coach.
All right, John, it's been a game dominated by offense. Each offensive unit over 200 yards in the first half of play, and Michigan striking within the final minute of the half to tie the game at 7-7. All right, let's go to New York now to check up on this weekend in college football. Let's go to Jim Lampley. Jim. And Meyer, perhaps to the surprise of most, has been frequently going to the air today. Michigan to kick off to start the second half.
So really this just comes down to one half of football.
Clint Johnson takes it at his 15. Johnson with a seam up the middle to the 33-yard line before he's tripped up by Nate Holdren. Notre Dame scoring first. Michigan answering just before intermission. The Notre Dame score coming on a terrific run by Reggie Brooks. He has averaged 10 yards a carry through the first half today. Had a bruised shoulder on his touchdown run as he took a terrific blow at the goal line, but back in now and ready to go. And it's a pitch to Brooks on first down. Twisting and turning, again showing that good balance that's been so much in evidence, but Shawnee Peoples pins him after a 2-yard gain.
Now, and after initially going to his passing game on first down, Lou Holtz has now reverted back to form in the first half on first down, 14 runs, 5 passes. That's what he would really like to do throughout the rest of this ball game. But so far, as you see, once again on first down, Michigan holding him to a 2-yard run.
Wise to either side. It's Johnson to the right, Dawson to the left. High formation in the backfield. Bettis, and Bettis with a huge hole up the middle to 50-yard line. Corwin Brown and Shawnee Peoples got him around the ankles, but Jerome Bettis for 15 behind the block of Aaron Taylor.
Peoples on the tackle.
Boy, and when Jerome Bettis breaks through a hole, you'll see there is nobody that is too anxious to come up and make the play. Corwin Brown, number 20, is left with the unpleasant duty of trying to tackle Jerome Bettis. Does a nice job of it.
Justin Hall made a terrific block on the play, too, to spring Bettis, who gets the call once again. Broke the initial tackle and then surrounded by the white jersey Wolverines. Shawnee Peoples again comes up from the strong safety spot and gets help from Steve Morrison. 10th carry of the game for the All-American Jerome Bettis. Coach Holtz had a talk with Bettis just last week about, before the Northwestern game, about perhaps coming out and turning pro after this, his junior season. And Coach Holtz says that they won't discuss it for the rest of the year. At the end of the season, they'll reevaluate the situation. Play action pass, and Meyer in trouble. The one-man rush does not succeed. The pass out of bounds and incomplete. Dwayne Ware was chasing Rick Meyer. He unloaded it, intended for William Pollard, but he was out of bounds.
Yeah, that was one of those plays that could have very easily have been a sack. Great hustle on the play by the fifth-year senior Justin Hall, number 73, their offensive tackle. He peeled back and nipped somebody right before he got to Rick Meyer on the play. It looked like it was Dwayne Ware coming from his right cornerback position.
Third and 7 for Notre Dame, only their second such situation of the game. They've had none any longer. And it's Dawson that gathers it in at the 30-yard line. Coleman Wallace and Corwin Brown catch up with Dawson, but not until he had a step on the defense and Meyer found him perfectly for 16 yards.
Lou Holtz really likes Lake Dawson. He said, you tell this young man to go run through a wall, and he'll spin his wheels trying to get it done. As you see, plenty of courage on the part of Lake Dawson. He knew Corwin Brown was coming, but he didn't care. Another big third down conversion for Notre Dame. They are now 5-for-6 on third down.
Dawson felt the wrath of Coach Holtz at a practice we attended last week. That was his third catch of the game. Draw play to Brooks, nets nothing. Hutchison and Dyson were there. Chris Hutchinson a little bit shaken up in the first half, but back on the field leading the Michigan defense.
Yeah, Chris Hutchinson is really an interesting story. He's a young man that usually gives up about 50 pounds in every game that he plays against his opponents, only weighing 245 pounds, goes against offensive linemen in the 300-pound category. Says that technique is the key for him, that he just has to keep his pads lower than his opponents and then work his hands inside and maneuver that offensive lineman.
Rick Meyer looking over a nickel Michigan defense on second and 11. And the intended receiver, Jerome Bettis, fell over one of the linemen attempting to block, tripped right over his feet as they tried to set up a middle fullback screen, it appeared.
Yeah, Mark Zadebeski really never gained control of his feet. You see him trying to throw his man out of the way. He stumbles, and Jerome Bettis had those big eyes. He thought he was going to get a chance to run behind those offensive linemen on the screen play, and all of a sudden he's on the turf.
This is the longest third down conversion by the Irish today. It's third and 11. Meyer, good protection, dips it off short and incomplete, intended for Clint Johnson. As the Wolverines had good coverage downfield, Meyer went to the safety valve and the pass falls incomplete.
You know, I had a chance to talk with a head coach in the National Football League this week, and he said the only thing that concerns him about Rick Meyer is his low completion percentage, that generally he doesn't throw much in the 60 to 65% range. And I think a big reason for that is that for the most part, Rick Meyer is left to throw on third and long situations, doesn't get many opportunities on first down.
Hendrick, a 48-yard field goal to try. He's the best kicker in college football, but that one blocked by Michigan. Picked up by Hendrick. But Michigan with a block. It might have been Steve Morrison in the center that was able to get the kick with a low trajectory block to the turf.
Earlier in this ball game, we saw Gary Moeller make the decision to punt when he could have tried a 50-yard field goal. And this is part of the reason why, because now you get the opportunity to take over the football at the 45-yard line. And this is a great scoring opportunity for this Michigan offense. The ball just never got up.
And it hit Corwin Brown right in the shoulder pads. Corwin Brown elevated, but the kick, a very low trajectory kick by Hendrick, never had a chance. And Corwin Brown gets credit for the block of Hendrick's field goal attempt. And Michigan will take over. Notre Dame's bid to take the lead foiled as Hendrick has his field goal attempt blocked. Let's go to John Dockery.
You know, Tom, there is another element involved in that long field goal attempt, the 48-yarder by Hendrick. The wind is actually blowing from right to left as you look at the field, and it's blowing into the kicker's face. Now, it's not that substantial wind, but still, it's right there. So he might have tried to jack that up a little more, and in doing so, got the low trajectory and the block. Back to you, Tom.
All right, Doc, as Michigan takes over after the Corwin Brown block, and good field position for the Wolverines just shy of their own 40. Powers and Leggett in the backfield. Counterplay to Powers, who nets only a yard. And the self-styled custodian of the sidelines, Mr. John Dockery.
Okay, Tom, I know that you and Chris have been up there wondering about the Michigan helmet. You know, the distinctive design. No, this is not an imitation of a Wolverine's claw, but rather back in 1938, then-coach Fritz Kreisler was looking for a way for his quarterback to be able to find his receivers downfield a little more easily. Thus, the distinctive stripes were born on the Michigan helmet. Yes.
Elvis has found them with regularity today, that's for sure. Here's a handoff to Leggett, and Bernie Leggett, the fullback, pounds ahead for 12 yards. Anthony Peterson with the tackle, but Leggett, a rare carry, and a Michigan first down. You know, I examined one of those Wolverine helmets in Ann Arbor the other day. That's just a detail. I thought that was fancy paintwork.
Bernie Leggett is a second-year starter for the Wolverines. He is, for the most part, a blocking back, but he does average 5 yards per carry, so he is a weapon when he gets his hands on the ball.
First down, Michigan in Notre Dame territory. quickly on the ground as Leggett, who got away a moment ago, can't get free of the tackle by Pete Bursich, who grabbed a leg and held on.
Yeah, all eyes have been on Pete Bursich in this ballgame, of course, filling in for Demetrius DeBose. And I have to say, based on what we've seen out of this Notre Dame defense, especially against the run, he has certainly done his job.
Bursich, the junior out of Mokena, Illinois, saying that this was his chance for recognition with DeBose on the sideline. He said he would be equal to the challenge. He didn't have the physical skills, perhaps, of Demetrius DeBose, but he had the savvy and the know-how to get the job done. Jesse Johnson in a tailback, almost broke free, got to the 35. Jeff Burris made a saving tackle. Johnson rips off 12 yards, and Michigan moving the football in his first possession of the second half.
Yeah, almost in the same way that Lou Holtz last week against Northwestern said, gentlemen, we're going to abandon the passing game to begin the second half, and just drove it right down the throats of Northwestern. In the same way, Gary Moeller now has not thrown a pass in this drive, just simply relying on that good, sound running game and his great offensive line.
Muller telling us earlier in the week, if he had his druthers, he'd like to run the football more often than usual. Johnson falls forward for a yard.
Well, now we shall see. So many times running the football fairly easy between the 30s because the defense have set back in order to not give up the big play. Now they're starting to come up a little more, challenge that running game. And we'll see if Gary Moeller finally calls his first pass. He says he loves calling his own plays. He doesn't do a lot with the defense, leaving that to defensive coordinator Lloyd Carr.
Walter Smith off the field as Mercury Hayes and Amani Toomer, two fresh wide receivers, come on the second down play. It's a draw play, though. And Notre Dame will have none of it. Jesse Johnson met in his tracks by John Tolliver. Tolliver, a 6'4", 226-pound sophomore from Riva, Maryland, has not gotten a whole lot of playing time. And number 44 was there to stop Johnson on the draw.
And here comes the spread formation, or at least looks like the three wide receiver formation for Michigan. Now they've put themselves in a bind. Notre Dame not able to convert on a third down and 11 play. Let's see if Michigan and Elvis Gerback can. Maybe look for them to go back to that play, the completion over the middle. That's where they've had success.
And Notre Dame, with a mix-up in the defense, is forced to call a timeout, and Lou Holtz is not happy about it.
And you want to know why? They've got 12 football players on the field for Notre Dame, so a heads-up play on the field. And you can count them on the field. I hope I counted accurately as we did it. But we shall see. There is one. That's not too close. So 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. How about that? That's kind of the way my daughter counts. Just points and does it.
And I think it was John Tolliver who made a tackle a moment ago that was the extra. Back at Notre Dame Stadium, where Lou Holtz is hoping his Irish defense can hold Gary Moeller's Wolverine offense on this third and 11. Nickel defense for Notre Dame. There's what the Wolverines have done on third and long. They're back. McGee, the tight end, short gain across the middle. He will be shy of the first down, wrapped up by Jeff Burris. Elvis Gerback in this game with the first pass of this drive has become the all-time leader in passes attempted for Michigan.
Decision time again for Gary Moeller. He has been in this situation before, right around the 30-yard line. It looked like he was clearly intending to go for it on fourth down. That was a play to set up this down, fourth and three.
He went for it before on fourth and three from the 33. He didn't make it, and Notre Dame scored on his next possession. This will be a pass. Gerback has Powers. Excuse me, Leggett. And Leggett is to the 25-yard line. Chased out of bounds by Brian Rattigan as Michigan goes to the fourth down pass to fullback Bernie Leggett.
Boy, it's so nice when you've got backs that can come out of the backfield and catch the football. Great play by Leggett, just getting it up the field. Notre Dame's defense not ready for that one.
So now the Wolverines threatening. They go with a two tight end formation here on first down. McGee and Burkholder with Wheatley on the ninth play of the drive. Leggett remains in the game. Wheatley hit it as his tracks, then shakes free and makes what appeared to be a loss into a 3 or 4 yard gain.
Pete Bursich simply made a huge mistake there. He tried to tackle Wheatley up around the shoulder pads. We showed you it in the pregame show where he had some trouble with open field tackles, but Pete Bursich in general will not miss a tackle like that. That is just simply a technique error.
Second and 7. Wheatley trying to bounce to the outside.
Wheatley.
And wrapped up and taken down by Oliver Gibson. Gibson came from the nose tackle spot to wrap up Wheatley.
Once again, another big opportunity for Michigan. They have been so far on third down and 4 yards or more, 5 for 8 in this ball game, and have been successful almost exclusively by throwing the football. A 3rd and 5 here.
7-7 game, 6:37 left in the third quarter. Michigan with a long drive, threatening. Just shy of the Notre Dame 10. Gerback rolling. Looking, firing, and knocked away. Batted down close to the line of scrimmage by Carmelia McGill.
That was an outstanding football play by Carmelia McGill. First of all, he doesn't commit towards the quarterback. Watch him. If he goes up right here and commits, then Leggett is wide open behind him. He lays there in that gray area, now jumps up, deflects the pass. That is an outstanding football play.
It forces Michigan to try for the field goal. A 27-yard attempt by Ella Zobik. This could give Michigan the lead. He's got it. A long drive by the Michigan Wolverines on their first possession of the second half. Nets a go-ahead field goal. Wolverines on top.
In 2 weeks, the intensity will reach the boiling point as the Purdue Boilermakers battle their upstate rivals, the Fighting Irish. Notre Dame football is home on NBC.
Tom Hammond, Chris Collinsworth, John Dockery at Notre Dame Stadium as we look down from the Goodyear blimp Spirit. Pilot today, Captain John Moran, a 25-year Goodyear veteran who has logged more than 10,000 hours with the blimp. Michigan blocking a Notre Dame field goal attempt, then a long 12-play drive that consumed 5.5 minutes. The go-ahead 28-yard field goal hits 10-7 Wolverines.
Yeah, and one thing that Lou Holtz was adamant about yesterday is he said, I don't want to put my defense in a bind. Well, that blocked field goal did exactly that, and Michigan came away with 3 points.
Ella Zobik, who kicked the field goal, now kicks off. Johnson chasing it down for Notre Dame. Picks it up. Penalty marker down as he is taken down at about the 17-yard line by Jean-Angus Charles, one of the true freshmen, the first one to see action for Michigan this season. Penalty against Notre Dame will set them even deeper in their territory.
Illegal block above the waist, half the distance to the goal line. First down.
Well, Michigan got a field goal to take the lead in the last possession, could have gotten more.
Yeah, let's go back to that last play. Watch Carmelia McGill right here. He's going to make a great play. They're going to send a back out here in the flat. McGill's going to have to try and make a play on both he and the quarterback. Now watch Gerback. Gerback's going to make a mistake here. Whoop. They're going to show that. You're going to see Gerback should have attacked the line of scrimmage there and forced McGill to do something in that situation when he did not.
Uh-oh. Notre Dame fumbles. Looked like the Irish got it back. Notre Dame set all the way back to its 7-yard line by the penalty. Meyer recovered the fumble.
Tom, to get back to that point, if Gerback had attacked the line of scrimmage, he would have forced McGill to make a decision between himself and the back coming out of the backfield. By not doing that, he really allowed him to play two different people.
Tim Ruddy and Rick Meyer fouling up the exchange from center there. Loss of a yard from their own 6. The Irish now facing a 2nd and 11. Quick toss by Meyer and a diving catch. Irv Smith, the tight end, went airborne to get it. It'll be short of the first down, but it takes it out with some breathing room now to the 14.
I'll bet you Lou Holtz, I bet you he almost choked when he saw Rick Meyer float this one out there, but a great play by Smith. But those are the kind of passes that often are picked off. I'm sure he gasped as that one was released.
Smith has played in the shadow of Derrick Brown, the great Irish tight end. Many said Smith was the second best tight end in the country. The problem was the best was playing in front of him, getting his chance now as a senior. Great defensive play there by Matt Dyson. Dyson got penetration along with Buster Stanley to trip up the play, and now Notre Dame must punt from deep in its territory.
Tom, I think that call by Lou Holtz was a result of the previous play. He saw Rick Meyer throw a very dangerous pass. We said he didn't want to put his defense in a bind. When he saw him throw the risky pass, he said, forget about it. I'll run on third down and just give my defense a little breathing room for this next drive.
Second punt of the afternoon by Hendrick. This one will come from his own end zone with Alexander awaiting it for Michigan. Alexander from his 41 got by the first couple of tacklers, still fighting his way forward before the Irish finally surround him and stop his forward progress. A 48-yard punt, 6-yard Alexander return, the momentum swinging to Michigan. Rick Mitter's Notre Dame defense has held Michigan to 10 points thus far. One of the new wrinkles he brought to this defense when he took over as coordinator was a wristband worn by defending players. Usually you see it on a quarterback, but they have some defensive calls on their wrist. He inaugurated in Ball State a few years ago in response to a no-huddle offense. Jesse Johnson is victim of a good defensive play by the Irish there. It was Bryant Young that got deep into the Michigan backfield to break it up. When I see one of those armbands on John Dockery on the field, Doc, what kind of defense is you calling today?
Let me talk. It's 22 blitz corner. But, it's a new system you were just talking about. What it helps against, especially a no-huddle offense, all he does is signal in a number, Tom. And then the player goes to his wristband, is always looking at his watch. He sees the number, and then he knows his assignment. It's quick, it's efficient, it's good communication for Notre Dame.
And it worked on that last play. Now Michigan with a second and 12. They're back again with no pressure on him. Nice defensive play, though, in the secondary made by Greg Lane of Notre Dame. The junior from Austin knocked the ball away intended for Malvo.
You see Elvis Gerback in the pocket, and I really am having a little bit of a problem believing what I saw just before that. Notre Dame was still in the defensive huddle, and Elvis Gerback waited for them to break the huddle before he snapped the ball. I mean, I just have no idea what he was thinking about.
Trips to the right, three wide receivers on third and long. Gerback steps up and goes long down the field. Alexander can't get it. Gerback trying to hook up with his favorite receiver, Derek Alexander, who drew double coverage. Tom Carter was closest to him, and Jeff Burris, the safety, coming to help.
Need that ball.
Eddie Ascona on for Michigan with his second punt of the day.
But a huge three and out by the Notre Dame defense.
Mike Miller awaiting the punt, and not a very good one. One of the up men calls for a fair catch and takes it. I think it was Dawson, Lake Dawson, with the fair catch. And Notre Dame will take over after only a 33-yard punt. Let's go down to John Dockery.
Wow, you hear that crowd in the background, but I was just going to make a point as we watch Notre Dame come out of the huddle, Tom, that Gerback has to prove that he can play without Desmond Howard, and you have to wonder on that last play when Alexander didn't make that catch whether Desmond Howard would have, and it would have been a touchdown.
Good point, Doc. Now Notre Dame trying to recapture the momentum fueled by this crowd, and Reggie Brooks looked like he had a steam going up before he was pounded by Shawnee Peoples, who made a form tackle right in the midsection of Reggie Brooks.
Shante Peoples is a huge, strong safety. 6'1", 227 pounds, and that was a big lick.
Clint Johnson is coming at wide receiver for Adrian Jarrell on second down and about six. Michigan leading Notre Dame 10-7 with 2:20 left in the third quarter. Delayed handoff to Brooks, who busts free and has a Notre Dame first down. Matt Dyson right in the center of the field. And Martin Davis finally catching up to Brooks. But a Notre Dame first down on another sterling run by Reggie Brooks.
In high school, Reggie Brooks averaged 9 yards per carry. So far this year at Notre Dame, just over 8 yards per carry. You are seeing an emerging star. So much is being said, so much written about Jerome Bettis and Rick Meyer, but clearly so far in this game, Reggie Brooks has been the story.
9 day and not through yet. Option play. Meyer keeps, thought about pitching and pulled it back down. A wise move. And got maybe 2 yards. Corwin Brown was ready for the option, and Shawnee Peoples was there too as they had Meyer up and had the pitch man covered.
Yeah, I've heard Lou Holtz criticized for running a great quarterback like Rick Meyer. You take the chance on him getting injured. But in talking with Michigan defensive coordinator Lloyd Parr, he said that the thing he was more afraid of than anything else in this ball game was that option game. He said, it almost literally keeps me out of man-to-man coverage because I cannot match up with the option game of Rick Meyer.
Meyer looks to throw and does. Dawson, diving catch just across the midfield stripe for a first down in Michigan territory. Lake Dawson didn't catch a pass against Northwestern in the opening game. 4 receptions, 58 yards, as the Irish fans now try to make their presence known. They've been relatively quiet in this game as the teams have moved up and down the field with that many points scored. Bettis. Fumble. And Michigan has it. Morrison takes it the other way for the Wolverines. Corwin Brown hit Jerome Bettis. The ball came free, and Morrison was the man that picked it up.
USC coach Larry Smith said that Bettis is the best college football fullback that he has ever seen, but he's still a human being. Corwin Brown came in to strip the football, makes another big play, and now the burden is back on the Notre Dame defense as they take the field. This is the third straight possession now that Notre Dame's defense has had to defend from around the 50-yard line. We'll see if they're up to the test.
Savvy senior Corwin Brown ripping the ball loose from Bettis. And now Michigan takes over just short of the 50-yard line. Two tight ends, McGee and Burkholder, as the Irish have turned it over for the third time. Play action pass. Gerbach to Smith. Away from one man and still loose. Smith all the way to the Notre Dame 35-yard line. 16-yard gain, and Smith took a short completion and really turned it into something before he was collared by Jeff Burris.
This is another thing that Rick Minner was talking about, the defensive coordinator of Notre Dame. He said, the difference between playing a Michigan and playing a Northwestern like we did last week is what these people can do after they catch the football. There is a perfect example, Walter Smith, with an outstanding play.
4 receptions, 70 yards for Smith today. First down, Michigan, just inside the 35 of Notre Dame. Time running out in the third quarter, Michigan leading by 3. Wheatley, kept the legs driving, powers his way for 5 yards to the 30. John Covington made the stop, but the fumble by the All-American from Notre Dame, Jerome Bettis, has put Michigan in position to add to their lead. That's the end of the third quarter with a score of Michigan 10, Notre Dame 7. Back to Notre Dame after these messages from your local station. A Notre Dame tradition as the fan gets into the spirit of the 1812 overture played by the Notre Dame band. Peter Tchaikovsky played at Notre Dame himself back in the turn of the century, didn't he? I think.
How impressive are you?
Maybe not. The Notre Dame offense has racked up 305 yards today, but three fumbles have given them only 7 points on the scoreboard. And now, after a Bettis fumble, Michigan with a first down at the Irish 30. A game with national championship implications, even though it's early in the season. Play action pass from Elvis Gerbach. Going for the end zone. Going for Alexander. He's got it for the Michigan touchdown.
Supposed to be matched with the great Desmond Howard as one of the best passing tandems in all of football and all of college football. But now he gets his opportunity here against Notre Dame, and he has certainly taken advantage of it. Man-to-man coverage down the field, and he is going against the best cover guy Notre Dame has to offer, Tom Carter, but he has beaten him all day long. Great pattern by Derek Alexander.
What do they say? When the door closes for someone, it opens for someone else. When Alexander was injured last year, it probably helped Desmond Howard win the Heisman Trophy because he didn't split the receptions with Alexander. Elizovic for the extra point, and it's good. First play of the fourth quarter is a Michigan touchdown, 30 yards, Gerbach to Alexander.
It's a nightmare for a defensive back. Inside technique, the post corner. Eyes come back to the quarterback. Carter bit on it, and now he's wide open. All Gerbach has to do is get him the ball. Elvis Gerbach got exactly what he was hoping for, man-to-man coverage, and Derek Alexander just too much. You won't see many teams the rest of the season try and cover him man-to-man. If Tom Carter can't get it done, not many people will.
Let's go to John Dockery.
You know, Chris, as an old defensive back, I can relate to what you're saying. The post corner man-on-man is almost an impossible to cover. But it was interesting, before the game, Gerbach threw about 20 of those and only completed about three or four. That one was perfectly thrown to Alexander for the touchdown. Back to you.
Elvis is still in the building, and Alexander the Great makes a 30-yard catch. And now 14 of Michigan's 17 points have come after Notre Dame turnovers.
Tom, you know, the hardest part about that post corner is to not get too excited too fast when you see the man-to-man coverage. I've seen a lot of people blow that route.
Becton with a good return for Notre Dame. He's all the way out to the 35-yard line. And now Rick Meyer down 17-7. Don't forget, coming up tomorrow, a doubleheader week on NBC as we switch to NFL action. NFL Live starts it all off at 12:30. Most of you will see the Raiders and the Bengals in the first game. In the second game, the majority of the country will watch Buffalo and San Francisco. That's the NFL tomorrow here on NBC. First down pass, Rick Meyer. And it's complete in the Michigan territory. Lake Dawson with another clutch catch as Meyer put the ball right on the money to the 34 of the Wolverines. Excuse me, the 44. Corwin Brown and Shawnee Peoples after a 22-yard gain.
Well, Rick Meyer, if you want to win the Heisman Trophy, here's your opportunity. Lou Holtz has to give you the chance to throw the ball now. There was a seam in the zone defense. And Dawson once again coming up with another catch. This is what Rick Meyer has been waiting for, though, the opportunity to run a wide open Notre Dame offense.
Hand off to Bettis. He fumbled his last carry, makes a beautiful move to the inside, switches the ball to the outside hand, and is knocked out of bounds at the 27-yard line by Peoples. Bettis had a determined look that time as he took the handoff.
But you see what throwing on first down does for the Notre Dame offense. The Michigan defense had to respect the pass there, and Jerome Bettis able to bounce it outside. Good play calling. Perhaps the best start to a drive for Notre Dame so far in the game.
And how many 250-pound fullbacks have you seen make those kind of moves, the fakes and feints to get to the outside? Brooks hit in the backfield. stopped for a loss on the play. Steve Morrison got penetration from a linebacker spot, and Brooks never had a chance.
That's a nice play by Steve Morrison. He led Michigan last year with 4 interceptions, had 11 tackles in 2 different games, but he broke his leg and missed 4 games. So he's hoping for his first injury-free season of his career.
Michigan now goes to the nickel defense. Notre Dame has it 2nd and 11. That's the time left in the game. Michigan by 10. And that play will be blown dead. They didn't get it off in time. Delay of game sets the Irish back 5. Was it that or a illegal procedure?
Offense.
It is delay of game.
Delay of game. And you know what happened? Rick Meyer called an audible on that play. He saw the defensive backs playing way off, just wanted to hit the quick hitch. And you watch Jerome Bettis step up, because on that quick set, he has to be able to go attack the defensive end. And in general, what backs want to do is try and get those defensive ends' hands down so they can't block the pass.
So that sets up a 2nd and 16 now for Notre Dame. Ball at the Michigan 31. Incomplete pass intended for Clint Johnson. And it'll be 3rd and long.
That's the flanker screen that worked so well against Michigan a year ago. When we talked to Skip Holtz yesterday, he said that Rick Meyer will make a lot of big plays, but against Northwestern, he missed some fairly easy passes that hurt this offense and their ability to go on down the field and sustain some long drives. Once again, as you see Skip Holtz in the press box, obviously not happy. Wouldn't be surprised if he made that call.
Huge play for the Irish. Meyer now will scramble. Made a nice move to get away from one man, but there are too many Wolverines around him. He got about 5 yards, but it'll be 10 short of the first down. Martin Davis made sure he wasn't able to gain any more, and then Coleman Wallace put on the finishing touches. Decision time here for Holtz.
Well, don't forget, he had his last field goal blocked. They are down by 10 points. And apparently he's going to go for it on 4th down.
Wow.
That doesn't show a lot of faith in your kicking game. When you're down 10, you need 2 scores. You need a touchdown and a field goal. But Lou Holtz choosing to go for the touchdown now.
Myers pass on target to Dawson at the 15.
You just get the feeling that Lou Holtz didn't have a lot of confidence in his defense's ability to come back and shut down Michigan. Lake Dawson again making a huge play. He was forced out of bounds, so he did not have to get 1 foot down.
First down at the 15. Bettis. Powerful running by Bettis. Taking defenders with him. Finally, Walker and Dyson combined to get him down.
Certainly enough time in this ball game that even if Notre Dame does not get the touchdown here, they can still win this football game. But when you get an opportunity once again, now inside the 15-yard line, this is where Notre Dame has been making their mistakes in this ball game. They've got to be careful of the offsides and execute on this part of the field.
17-7 Michigan, 11:40 left in the game. Play-action pass, and Meyer in trouble. Got away from one man, got away from the second man, and let it go. Incomplete. Meyer averting the sack. Tony Henderson had him for a huge loss. He was able, on the way down, to get rid of the football.
Take a look at Irv Smith, the tight end on this play. He is absolutely wide open. But Rick Meyer didn't have a lot of time to search for his wide receivers on that play, as Tony Henderson almost made the sack.
Tight end and has not been a favorite target to the Notre Dame offense in years past. That time Smith open, but Meyer narrowly averting the first sack of the game. Here's the ninth play of the Notre Dame drive. Meyer to Dawson, not free. And a penalty marker down. Ty Law, a true freshman, defending on the play.
Ty Law not arguing the call. But that man doesn't like it. Gary Moeller, a bang bang play, but it did look like Law got there just
pass
a little
interference.
Early.
Defense, the ball will be placed on the 2 yard line. First down.
Just a little bit early.
Could be a key call, a crucial call in this game. It gives Notre Dame a first and goal at the Michigan 2. Two tight end formation, Smith and McBride. Full house backfield, the old T formation. Up the middle, Bettis for the touchdown.
Down play, the interference call. Don't know if Lou Holtz would have gone for it or not. It's certainly a huge call by the officials.
Hendricks' extra point is good. After the interference call on Law, first and goal, Notre Dame. Who else? Jerome Bettis gets the call. And the 2 yard run for the score by Bettis narrows the gap to 3. Things are heating up in South Bend. Michigan scores to go up by 10 on the first play of the fourth quarter. Notre Dame answers on a touchdown run by Jerome Bettis.
Just a straight tee, and why not? Hand it to the best fullback in the country.
Remember, it was a Bettis fumble that led to the Michigan touchdown to start the fourth quarter, and Gary Moeller on the Michigan sideline sees Notre Dame pull within 3. That doesn't need any explanation.
Is this starting to remind you of anything? The score, 17-14 here in the fourth quarter. Almost an exact replica of last year's game.
Hendrick with the kick. Wheatley backpedals to take it just short of the goal line. Almost burst free, Wheatley to the 25-yard line. Well, last year at Michigan Stadium in Ann Arbor, it was 17-14 Michigan. On this fourth down play, Gerback and Desmond Howard. It's one that you've seen many times and will continue to see.
Gary Moeller said of that play, yeah, I was a big hero that day, but if we had thrown an incompletion, they'd have been ready to hang me.
And it was Gerback that read the defense at the line of scrimmage and checked off to his old high school teammate, Desmond Howard. And Gerback and the Wolverines went on to win it, 24-14. This is the first year in 7 that Gerback has not been on the same team with Desmond Howard. Howard, of course, now with the Washington Redskins. Give to Powers, hit in the backfield, spun down by Pete Bursich. Bursich taking over for the suspended Demetrius DeBose with a big defensive play.
Take a look at Pete Bursich. We told you he's filling in for Demetrius DeBose. He has never had a problem in stopping the run.
And Powers again is stopped on the run after a gain of only 1 yard as Michigan keeps it on the ground and Notre Dame playing tough against the run here.
You see him right here. The position held for so long by Demetrius DeBose. The tackle not able to come off and get a piece of him. And now Notre Dame's defense is answering the call. We talked about Rick Meyer having to make something happen. Well, now it's Elvis Gerback's time.
Nickel defense for Notre Dame. Three wide receivers for Michigan. Flag down. Notre Dame might have been offside. This could be a free play, and it'll be blown dead. Or was it Michigan jumping too soon? Let's see. It will be against the Wolverines. Notre Dame drawn offside by premature Michigan movement.
Now it's decision time for Gary Moeller. He is going to face a third down.
Good ball. Third side. Offense.
A third down and about 13. Remember, he still has a three-point lead. Now, do you take a chance on a turnover in this situation, throwing it into a nickel or a dime defense, or do you simply do something fairly conservative, punt it, and give your defense a chance to win this football game? I think he throws.
Stopped by Flanagan and McGill. First sack of the game.
Looks like Elvis Gerback may have hurt himself on that play. Lou Holtz knows that his powerful offense now will have a chance to take the lead.
As Kona to punt. Miller, the deep man for the Irish. Good high kick as Kona. Miller backpedaling all the way back to his 34-yard line. Dodging free. Miller caught from behind just as he was about to break loose. Martin Davis made a saving tackle from behind. There is a penalty marker down. Flag on the play as Gerback receiving some attention on the sideline. Matt Dyson also is an injured player as Notre Dame will be called for an illegal block.
Boy, that's a huge penalty. That really is a huge penalty. Take a look right in the middle of your screen. I believe, I can't really tell exactly who that was, but this penalty negates a nice run by Miller. And now, rather than having the ball across midfield, Notre Dame is going to be backed up inside the 30-yard line. And not good news for Michigan fans, as Elvis Gerback apparently has hurt his ankle. And that's Todd Collins warming up for the Wolverines.
Collins, redshirt sophomore from Walpole, Massachusetts, is the backup quarterback. Played in six games last year. He could take over, but Notre Dame will have the ball. Another chapter being written in this wonderful rivalry. Michigan clinging to a three-point lead, but was Elvis Gerback shaken up that last series? John Dockery?
You know, Tom, he's right behind me. You see him on the phone there. Not a trainer or a doctor came over to check him out. Actually, they just taped his left foot. You see him walking along the sideline right now. He's fine. He will play. He won't come out of a game as big as this one.
All right, Doc. So Gerback poised to return when the Wolverines regain possession of the ball. Right now, though, Notre Dame has the offense on the field. First down from their own 29-yard line. Play action pass, first down. Wide open receiver is Jerome Bettis. Bettis, from his fullback spot, takes it for a gain to the 46-yard line and a Notre Dame first down. Walker and Wallace with the tackle for Michigan. Were you surprised to see Bettis on the receiving end?
Well, not after what Skip Holtz told us yesterday. He said this guy could be a wide receiver on our team. He'd look a little funny at 250 pounds playing wide receiver. But take a look at Coleman Wallace. Watch him bounce off, almost like he wasn't there.
Dean Lytle making a nice block there, too. A 16-yard gain. Notre Dame with a first down. Lee Becton in at the tailback spot. Gets the handoff. Becton slithering forward across the 50-yard line down to the Michigan 49, where he's covered by Steve Morrison and Tony Henderson. Matt Dyson, shaken up for Michigan a moment ago, has returned to the game.
But a good first down play for Notre Dame. Now in about a second and six situation. Wouldn't surprise me to see Lou Holtz try and run it two more times to pick up a first down, although his passing game has certainly been very effective. Rick Meyer has been playing outstanding football.
Hand Becton. 2 yards on that carry. Dwayne Ware hanging on to Becton's legs, and it'll be third down for Holtz's offense. Very rare to see both head coaches calling the plays in this game.
Yeah, Tom, I can't remember a time during any Notre Dame drive in which they have picked up a first down with three straight runs. In general, the way that they have been able to get first downs is to throw the ball at least once in any given series. We'll see how much confidence Lou Holtz has in that offensive line here. This is a long three.
Michigan was coming with the blitz, and it stops the run in its tracks. Marcus Walker wrapping up Lee Becton, or Reggie Brooks it was, and it'll be fourth down for Holtz, trailing by three.
Did you see Lou Holtz right there make the signal like a check? He's saying, Rick, you got the opportunity there to check out of that play. It was a double barrel blitz right up the middle of the field, a perfect call by defensive coordinator Lloyd Carr, and the worst play you can have on against a double barrel blitz is a draw. Just a great call defensively by Lloyd Carr.
Alexander awaiting the Hendrick punt. Low snap, one hopped it, but got it away. It'll hit and bounce into the end zone. Took a little lateral bounce for a moment, but the coverage couldn't catch up, and Michigan will take over after a 50-yard kick. Wolverines will have it at their 20, up three. Fabled Notre Dame Stadium for one of the great rivalries in college football, Michigan and Notre Dame. Two teams ranked in the top 10, two teams hoping for a national title, led by all-star quarterbacks, typically close, 17-14 Michigan. First down pass complete to Alexander. Alexander caught from behind by Burris, the safety, and then Carter came to make sure he didn't get away. Jeff Burris coming up to make the play on Derek Alexander, who scored a touchdown earlier in this quarter.
Notre Dame's defense doing a much better job here in the second half against the first down calls of Michigan. In the first half, Michigan averaged 6 yards per play. In the second half, just 2.6.
Quarterback passing for 226 yards today. Two scores, one picked off in the end zone. Second down pass from Durbach. Rolling to his right, throwing to his left. Caught by Wheatley. Wheatley with blockers. There's a penalty marker down. Wheatley spun out of bounds at about the 46-yard line. Flag on the play.
You always have to be careful on these plays to not let those offensive linemen release down the field too soon. You see the referee shaking his finger in the face of Elvis Gerbeck. And that's exactly what we've got. We'll try. Take a look at this side as the screen develops. They're going to slide out in front of the back. And because the ball was in the air too long, the offensive lineman, that's a timing.
On the offense. 5-yard penalty, repeat second down.
That's really a timing play on the part of the offensive line. They don't look back to see where the ball is, but it took so long in the air, they just got a little anxious, released down the field, and that was a huge penalty in the ball game. Now two big penalties against Michigan. That one that negates the big play and the pass interference which set up the touchdown.
Instead of a 24-yard gain, it's a 5-yard penalty. Lou Holtz in that familiar pose, picking at the grass. His defense trying to hold on. Second down and 12 for Michigan. Intercepted. Brian Rattigan stepped in front of Walter Smith to pick it off, and Notre Dame will have the ball inside the Michigan 20.
Disaster, because your offense is now forced to throw the ball. The defense knows it. Brian Rattigan with a great play.
First down, Notre Dame, just inside the 20-yard line. Option play. Meyer cuts up. He's close to the 15-yard line. Martin Davis toppled him there. Elvis Gerback, after pitching his second interception of the game, has given Notre Dame excellent field position. The Irish trailing by three and 6 minutes left in the game.
Well, Rick Meyer just does so many things well. Not only is he a great passer of the football, but he executed that option play absolutely perfectly. He waited. Then they took away the pitch back. He cuts it up, and now he puts his team in a second and five situation.
Meyer passes behind Dawson, the intended receiver.
That's a play that's been there all day for Lou Holtz. Just not able to execute at that time. Lake Dawson has been open much of the day in the slant pattern. You see Gerback on the sideline. You just can't afford to throw interceptions in your own end, especially when you have the lead. Michigan with the 17-14 lead. Nothing wrong with punting the football in that situation. This defense has been doing a good job all day long.
Third and five for the Irish. And Meyer takes a timeout. So the Fighting Irish, facing that crucial third and five play from the Michigan 15, are down to their final timeout. Will Gerbach's interception cost the Wolverines? Well, this has been a game as close as expected. Notre Dame took the early lead with a spectacular run by Reggie Brooks. In the second quarter, inside the final minute, Michigan tied it up before halftime as Tyrone Wheatley caught a pass from Gerbach. In the third quarter, Michigan got a field goal to go up by three. And then it looked like the Wolverines were taking command on the first play of the fourth quarter. Eric Alexander took a pass from Gerbach 30 yards, and Michigan led 17-7. But Notre Dame has come back to pull within three, 17-14, after a two-yard run by Bettis. Now the Irish have the ball at the Michigan 15 after the interception, facing a third and five, and the clock showing 5:40. Here's the interception that could wind up costing Michigan the game.
You'll see Brian Rattigan in his own defense just step in front of Walter Smith. Walter Smith just trying to find a hole in the zone for Brian Rattigan, the backup middle linebacker, making a huge play. Now let's talk about this call. You've got a third down and six situation. A great athlete in Rick Meyer at quarterback. In some way, you want to get him outside the pocket, give him the option to either throw the ball if someone's open or simply run it for the first down.
Meyer chased. Throws it. Incomplete. Marcus Walker flushed Meyer out. Tony Henderson then was bearing down on him, and all he can do is unload it, and now they'll go for the tying field goal.
Great play by Rick Meyer. Showed a lot of poise there. He knew that the number one thing that he could not allow was a sack. He was never really in danger of the sack. He tried to keep the play alive as long as possible and then simply threw it away when there was nothing there.
32-yard field goal attempt by Hendrick, who had one blocked earlier. This could tie it. Notre Dame turns the interception into 3 points, and we're tied at 17. The Notre Dame and Michigan fight songs have been voted the top two college fight songs in the country. We've heard a lot of them today. We're 17-17 with 5:28 left in the game. Tom Hammond, Chris Collinsworth, John Dockery with you. And living up to tradition, this one will be decided late in the game. Hendrick to kick off. And he kicks it out of the end zone. Hendrick is pumped up now. He had a field goal blocked earlier, but this latest one from 32 yards tied the game.
A lot of pressure on these young men. as this game winds down now in the final 5.5 minutes.
And how do you succeed a legend like Bo Schembechler? Well, Mo has done it with hard-nosed football. You think this guy had hard-nosed? Just a field goal, coach. I mean, what much they could do.
All right, Elvis Gerback back in the ballgame. He has to bounce back after throwing the interception. A nice job by the Michigan defense to keep Notre Dame out of the end zone. A tie score.
Gerback has thrown 2 interceptions today. He had only 6 all last season. Johnson hit and dropped. Bryant Young. Bryant Young has a friend on this Michigan team, Marcus Walker. They've been calling each other, sort of taunting each other back and forth, and that time Bryant Young had the last laugh.
Watch Bryant Young. He said that last week he felt like they really were missing their emotional leader, Demetrius DeBose. But look at him. Now he's the emotional leader.
Michigan has amassed only 32 yards in the fourth quarter, and 30 of those came on that first play, the touchdown pass. Johnson spurts free for a moment, makes about an 8-yard run out of it. John Covington finally able to stop him short of the first down.
We're seeing an awful lot of Jesse Johnson, and he's doing a nice job in this ballgame. Ricky Powers has not been much of a factor since the first quarter.
Johnson has carried 12 times for 56 yards. Gerbach went over to the sideline for a conference, just now back on the field in this 17-17 game, approaching 4 minutes. Play action pass. Gerbach will run. He, I think, has a first down by about a yard. It will be a Michigan first down. It looked like Gerbach was going to throw, tucked it under, was able to dive forward before he was tackled by Greg Lane, and has a Michigan first.
That was really a nice decision by Elvis Gerbach. He had tight end Tony McGee wide open in the flat, and yet he knew he could get enough for the first down. Why take a chance on an incomplete pass? Just go get it. He paid the price for it, but he picked up the first down.
Could be the first step toward a national championship for one of these teams. Johnson tries the middle, probes for about 3 yards. Bryant Young again at the bottom of the defensive stack for Holtz's Irish.
Yeah, that was a huge first down for Michigan, because now this clock continues to run. Inside 3.5 minutes to play now, Michigan has the football. They want to put themselves in a position where they can't lose the game. If they don't win, they come out of here with a tie, that's okay. But you don't want to give the ball back to this Notre Dame offense and give them a chance to beat you.
Eric Alexander running onto the field late for Michigan, setting out wide to the right. 2nd and 7. On the ground again to Johnson. Only a yard. Hit almost immediately by Pete Bursich. Now inside 3 minutes.
You are looking at the play of the game right now. 3rd down, about 6 yards to go. Michigan picks up the first down, keeps the drive alive, or they have to give Notre Dame a chance to win it. Watching that all day long. Derek Alexander on Tom Carter. Tom Carter is a great football player, but Derek Alexander is teaching him a thing or two this afternoon. Boy, you just have to wonder, how good would Michigan have been if they would have had Derek Alexander and Desmond Howard together last year?
Alexander, 6 catches, 94 yards. Michigan with a first down in Notre Dame territory at the 47-yard line. 2:14 left in a tie game. Johnson, Barry. Anthony Peterson ripped off his helmet as Johnson went down after a short gain, and the clock continues to tick, now showing 2 minutes left.
Michigan has done exactly what Gary Moeller had hoped, and that's put themselves in a position where only they can now win the football game. They need to pick up about 15 to 16 yards in the next minute and 47 seconds to give them a legitimate shot at a field goal. But you see them taking their time. The last thing they want to do is to ever have to turn the ball back to Notre Dame.
Wheatley breaks free. Wheatley to the outside. To the 30-yard line before he's caught by Jeff Burris. 17-yard gain. Wheatley perhaps shaken up on the tackle as Burris caught him from behind.
Once again, the Michigan offensive line doing the job, opening a huge hole for Tyrone Wheatley. And that was a huge play for this Michigan offense. Now they are in legitimate field goal range. Oh, you see, oh goodness, he did a split at the end of the play. His spikes just slipped out from underneath him. And he did a complete split. You hope he didn't snap a groin or a hamstring on that play. But he'll probably take it. He put his team in a position now where they will have a 47-yard field goal attempt if they don't make it another yard.
And there is Peter Elizovic, the place kicker, a junior from Farmington Hills, Michigan. He didn't play last year, played only one game in 1990, didn't play in 1989. Very inexperienced. It could come down to his leg. Durbach. Throw it right to Notre Dame. Picked off by Burris. What in the world happened? Durbach threw it right to Jeff Burris of Notre Dame. There wasn't a Michigan player within 20 yards.
Take a look. I have no idea. Looked like he was hit when he threw it. Before he threw the football, he was hit in the back, and that snapped his arm around his body, and that's what caused it. Greg Lane came on a corner blitz and forced the ball out of his hand in the wrong direction. Amazing. I don't think I've ever seen that.
What a huge break for Notre Dame, and now they take over just beyond their own 10 with a minute five and only one timeout left. On the ground to Bettis on the draw play. He's short of the 20, and the precious seconds continue to tick away.
Now Notre Dame doesn't want to give Michigan the opportunity to get the football back, but they still want to take a shot at winning the game. I'm surprised they're going back to the huddle. Only 43 seconds remain.
Meyer wears number 3, the same number worn at Notre Dame by Joe Montana. Can he pull one out a la Montana here? Again on the ground, Brooks. Flag on the play. Why are they running the football?
My only thought is that perhaps Lou Holtz wants to pick up at least one first down. He doesn't want to put his team in a position where they're going to turn it back on downs to Michigan, so that if he picks up the one first down, he'll run enough of that clock off. He can go into the two-minute mode and hopefully go down the field. But
there are only 30 seconds left.
I've got to agree with you. That's a shocker.
Shades of the famous 10-10 Notre Dame-Michigan State tie.
Illegal formation, not enough men on the line, offense down.
You see the agony of Elvis Gerbach. Two interceptions have really cost his team the opportunity to win this football game. Two consecutive.
Maybe Lou Holtz doesn't want to risk a turnover and giving Michigan a chance to win the game deep in his own territory, is playing it safe.
I think that's exactly what you're seeing. That Lou Holtz is satisfied to come out of here with a tie. The clock is moving. They're down to 18 seconds.
This will be a pass, maybe for the game. Meyer heaves it. Dawson caught it out of bounds. Incomplete. 7 seconds left.
Tom, I really have no explanation for exactly what's going on.
They didn't even take a timeout to stop the clock. They have one left.
You're looking here at a Notre Dame offense that essentially is running out the clock. They had about a minute to go in this ball game. I just don't know if Lou Holtz wanted to take the chance on turning it back over to Michigan.
To hear the boos. That doesn't happen often for the home team in Notre Dame Stadium.
I think the offense of Notre Dame is as shocked as the crowd is. Those guys went screaming onto the field. They thought they were going to have the opportunity to win the football game. They had a timeout remaining. But remember, Michigan had three timeouts themselves. So now if you put yourself in a position to where you run it on first or second down, or you throw a couple of incomplete passes, then you would have had to have picked up a first down, or you've got to punt the ball back to Michigan with three timeouts and a great likelihood that you lose the football game.
And I realize it's early in the season, but if you think of national championships, a tie against a highly rated team probably won't detract too much from either of these clubs' chances of winning the national title unless somebody does go through the year undefeated.
Just too bad, though. You see a football game like this that will end in a tie. These two teams are pounding on each other for four quarters. We'd really like to see the overtime come into play in this ball game. Just let them go until somebody wins it. I don't think they'll even throw the football here, Tom. What you've seen now is that they're going to be fairly well satisfied to play this thing to a tie.
Remember 1966 when Ara Parseghian, the Notre Dame coach, elected to stay with a 10-10 tie? They're still talking about that one. Maybe they'll discuss this one 20 years from now. Myers takes to one side, goes down the middle of the field. This is the last play of the game, and it's intercepted by Corwin Brown. And the crowd somewhat stunned. Face of one of the officials. And I got to be honest, after all the emotion of the day, this is kind of an empty feeling.
And look at the players on the field. You're seeing the exact same. It's almost like they don't want to stop. They want to continue to play because this thing has been left undecided. This is as quiet as this stadium has been all day.
Gerback had three interceptions, half of his total all last season. Meyer rallied his team to come from behind a tie. But the game ends in a tie. Let's go to John Dockery.
What was your thinking late in the game?
What, how late?
Very late in the game. When you got the ball back with about a minute left, a couple of running plays.
Well, what we wanted to do, we wanted to get a first down to see what coverages they were in. And then we were going to pick it up and come back and throw. We got some people open. Well, we didn't want to just come out there and throw and not have any idea what kind of coverage they have. Multiple defense, they change it up. Once we ran, got a first down, we had a call back by a penalty. We'd see what the coverage were. Then we had a guy open, and, of course, they called it back. And we were going to win the football game. We weren't playing for a tie, but we wanted to see the coverage they were in. That's why we ran it for the first down.
It was a very tight situation, obviously, late in the game. You only had one timeout left. You ran those two plays. You were eating up that clock. It appeared, though, that maybe you're playing it too close to the vest.
I was playing to win and give our kids a chance to play. You want second guess? That's your prerogative. It's easy to sit up. We want to find out what the coverage. Please listen. Read
okay,
my lips.
Okay,
we wanted to find out what the coverage was. That's why we ran the football. Then we're going to throw it. We weren't playing for a tie or anything else. You don't come to Notre Dame to play for a tie.
But could you have found out the coverage by throwing the ball as well?
Well, maybe into the wrong coverage or something along that line. That's a good football team.
Okay, the loss was it. Okay.
Hey. Right, Chris, what's your reaction?
Well, I honestly felt like that he had to pick up a first down, that he was going to pick up a first down. He was afraid of the three timeouts that Michigan had remaining and simply did not want to put his defense in a position to have to stop Michigan's offense one more time. That if, in fact, he broke loose on one of those draw plays or running plays, now he goes up to the line of scrimmage and tries to make something happen offensively, but he had to have at least one first down, and that's what he was going for.
So after nearly 400 yards of offense on either team, by either team, we wind up in a tie. And our Chevrolet players of the game, Tyrone Wheatley of Michigan, Reggie Brooks of Notre Dame. In conjunction with this program, Chevrolet will contribute $2,000 to the National Association of Student Financial Aid Administrators for disbursement to deserving college students so that they may continue their education. It was a game filled with offensive fireworks with some mistakes. Notre Dame took the early lead. Michigan came back. In the final analysis, it was Notre Dame that tied it up. And then, time running out, a 17-17 tie. Tom Hammond for Chris Collinsworth and John Dockery saying so long. Stay tuned for volleyball.